the Cape's leader. Sports radio play by play.
Go A's!
Chatham on TRC.
Under the lights at Veterans Field, the Anglers complete this huge four-game homestand. East versus West, the Cotuit Kettleers are in town. Two struggling teams looking to right the ship tonight. Alongside Ben Shulman, Emmanuel Berbari with you. Ben, the Anglers entered this homestand hoping it would be a turning point in their season off a 2-out-of-3 road trip. Instead, they've dropped 3 straight and 2 of them in excruciating fashion.
It's an absolute 180 turn from where we were a few days ago when Chatham thought that they could vie for that top spot in the East Division by having a good homestand. The Anglers have lost a pair of one-run games, one game where they only scored one run and got blown out. And this is about as bad of a losing streak as they've had to this point this season.
But Ben, if there's a stopper on this Anglers staff, he takes the ball tonight. It's Adam Tulloch.
Tulloch has been the ace this year. He's really had 2 bad innings out of his about 20. So if he can get on the mound and buy time for this Chatham offense to get its rhythm back, he could be the guy that in 4 innings acts as a stopper for the A's.
We'll see if Tulloch can lock down the fort tonight. It's a 9-14-3 Anglers, the 11-13 Kettleers. Both teams on abbreviated losing streaks. What gives tonight? Cotuit has won the first 2 meetings against Chatham this season. We find out what will give in a rematch of 5 days ago. Adam Tulloch against Will Jacobson. The pitching matchup, the lineup, so much more up next on the Anglers Extra Pregame Show.
Sports Radio, play by play. Go A's! Chatham on TRC.
Chatham Bars Inn is Cape Cod's premier 4-diamond oceanfront resort. With 217 luxurious rooms, guests have access to numerous amenities, including a private beach, complimentary children's programs, 4 award-winning restaurants, a new world-class spa, an outdoor pool, and tennis courts. Year after year, Chatham Bars Inn is recognized as one of the top resorts in the world. Chatham Bars Inn and Cape Cod Baseball. Summer fun for the whole family.
Welcome back to the Anglers Extra Pregame Show. The A's wrap up a homestand welcoming the Cotuit Kettleers to Veterans Field. It's time for the manager show with Chatham manager Tom Holliday, Emmanuel Berbari. Coach, your team wrapping up a streak of 8 games in a row, 8 days in a row. What's the feeling like with the team right now?
Well, you just kind of wait till you get to the yard and you kind of watch your body language a little bit. And, you know, 3 days ago, we were like 3 points out of first place. Now we're, I don't know, 6 points, 8 points, whatever. But just goes to show you what hot and cold can do. So right now it's like let's finish this thing up at home. Tough game last night. But again, you know, short memory has to play in here. And the beauty of having so many different personalities, you know, we got 3 different guys throwing tonight, and it's not like we can look for our stopper, you know, who's our guy that turns this thing around, because we got so many guys involved. But you know, this will be a battle like every night is up here.
You mentioned a couple of really close games over this stretch. How razor thin is that line between winning and losing right now?
Last night was like you know, to watch Maxwell come out and throw that well late in the game and appear to be comfortable in a closing situation like that, and not like we were playing for a tie, because we weren't. But the bottom line is, you know, you got to stop them to get us a chance to win. And he did, and we did have a chance to win. And then a 3-2 pitch that maybe the guy cheated a little bit, and the way he's been throwing his curveball with nobody on base, we've kind of talked about the, you know, don't walk people. So he throws a fastball, 93 down the middle. If it would have been the curveball that he'd been throwing that inning, who knows? the beauty of second-guessing baseball. You know, that's what everybody, that's why people show up every night, to be able to second-guess the decisions that are made in baseball. Bottom line was, Maxie pitched really well. All three guys did. You know, Medeiros was, like, so efficient last night. I mean, he went, what, four? With, you know, and again, we're keeping a close eye on him. But he went four, 40-some pitches, 43 pitches, and did it really, really well, you know, with a great look about him. And, you know, Nielsen is a guy that he excites me so much every time he pitches. You know, I just see him, you know, pitching in the big leagues. And yet, as soon as something really small happens, you know, he seems to crack a little bit, you know, and when he gets over that hump, he's got a chance to be a special guy. I mean, last night he threw 289-mile-an-hour changeups, which is not good. You know, it's not good. Your fastball is 93, 94. But, boy, when he conquers that with that breaking ball, he's got a chance to be a special guy. So I know you guys are, like, into winning and losing and questioning why we win and lose. And there's still a lot of growing going on. There's a lot of kids making a move in the right direction for their immediate future.
Speaking of left-handed pitching and speaking of movement, you have Adam Tulloch taking the ball again tonight. Second start since he was drafted by the Dodgers. What's the next step for him in his development as he puts everything together?
Well, he has accepted the pressure of pitching under draft. And he wanted the pressure to pitch in front of the draft. And then he gets drafted, and certainly drafted by a great organization. The round is a teaser, and the Dodgers got a small budget. And so as they sign their drafts, which is going on as we speak, they'll have to decide whether they have enough money to sign him or not. He's a young 21-year-old, and, you know, you'd like to give him everything, you know, to make life easier, but this life's not easy right now for Tulloch. He's pitching. He's picked a school. He got that off his mind. So he now knows where he's going to school next year. He seems to be very happy about that. And, you know, I mean, he's only going to get two more starts. I mean, he's two more starts from being done. And, quite frankly, the Dodgers have until, I think, maybe the first day of school or the 1st of August. I don't know which one, but again, if they don't find the money, he's going to school. If they find the money, he signs. But in his life, this has probably been the most hectic 20 days of his life. And you know what? If they grow up from that, then, boy, this is all worth it. But the draft is a thing that every kid wants in their life. He's getting it, and he's getting both sides, the pressure in front of it and the pressure after it. So, again, I have no idea who's going to show up tonight. I thought last time he pitched, he looked like he had something on his mind. Tonight, I don't know. We'll see. We'll find out. But whatever it is, he's our guy tonight, and he's been very good for us. So, again, you'd like to win the last game of this homestand, and then you get a day off. 8 days in a row has been hard on him. You know, I got some nicks. I got some sore arms. And when you drift out of the contention for first place, all of a sudden you start hearing about you know, my coach said that if this and that, you know, I can come home. Well, shame on them. That will be the sad part. You know, if anybody bolts because, you know, we don't have anything to play for. We have a little bit of pride to play for. And the people in Chatham who sponsored this organization.
Someone who hasn't let up during this 10-game stretch is Matt Hogan. How nice are those tools to watch?
Well, it's a legit coming out party for Matt Hogan. And, you know, Corbs has been like number one supporter. And again, you know, when you lose the battle of playing time in college and you stay a good teammate, it's kind of cool to know that your coach is pulling for you thick and thin. He's entered the transfer portal. He wants to play. He's playing lights out. I mean, he has that energy that it gets stored up when you don't play, you know. And everybody that's ever played this game has a hump to get over. And, you know, this is like him getting caught up for the last 2 years. And he's not angry or agitated. He just loves to play. Whatever happens, happens. Yeah, you know, there's a mention like, Coach, you know, I don't know where I'm going to go to school next year. If you can help me. Well, he's helping himself by playing in the way he's playing. Somebody would be crazy not to take him. And you know, he needs to connect to the right school. But right now, every time I put down a lineup, I want to put him in a one hole. Then I want to put him in the two hole. Then I want to put him in the three hole. Then I want to put him in the five hole. And I like to have him in the six hole. So when you get a guy going that good, that no matter what you do, you like, you feel like he'd make us good and better that day, whatever hole I put him in, yeah, I'd say he'd open my eyes.
Two hole for Hogan tonight. Coach, appreciate the time.
You bet.
It's Chatham manager Tom Holliday on the Manager's Show. Send it back up to Ben Shulman as the pregame show continues.
Well, in exchange for having Hogan in all nine spots, Tom did have to fill up a lineup tonight. And we will go over that lineup when we come back. We also have the pitching matchup and catch of the day. Straight ahead on the Angler's Extra pregame show.
Angler's Extra. Chatham on TRC. Cape Cod.
Curry College offers 20 traditional undergraduate degree programs, over 65 minors and concentrations, and a wide array of extracurricular activities, ranging from 14 NCAA Division III athletic teams to an outstanding theater program. Explore Curry College at curry.edu.
Back at Veterans Field, the Angler's Extra pregame show rolls on. He's Victor Medeiros. I'm Ben Shulman. It's time for catch of the day. Victor, you were yesterday's starting pitcher, and you went nearly four innings of two-run ball. What was the key to your success in that game?
I think just being aggressive with the hitters. You know, I know the hitters were hitting fastballs, so, you know, just kind of throw it over the plate and, you know, see what happens.
You were incredibly efficient with your pitches. What about your game plan helped you do that?
You know, me and Cookie kind of went over a plan. You know, I had the first start, didn't go as well. And, you know, just coming into this start, I just felt like I just had to control the ball, you know, both sides of the plate and just kind of attack hitters and, you know, not go around it.
You're typically a guy who people would consider has strikeout stuff. How do you feel about going through the whole appearance yesterday without striking out a batter?
So I think it's different coming from the bullpen than it is coming in from a starting perspective. Coming in from a starting perspective, you know, you want to go deep into games. You kind of don't want to get into, you know, two strike counts or, you know, three ball counts. So, you know, you kind of just want to attack the hitter. You know, if you get to two strikes, then yeah, you want to go after him and, you know, get that strikeout. But, you know, if the hitter wants to get himself out, then you just go after him and, you know, make him put the ball in play.
What do you see as the future for Victor Medeiros? More of a starting role or a relieving role?
You know, I've always been a starter. At Miami, I was a starter. Got put in the bullpen after, but, you know, I've always, you know, try to go deep into games and, you know, give a chance for my team to win.
So a few days ago, you were playing shortstop during batting practice, giving Josh Rivera a bit of a hard time that you were going to take his job. What is that like for you to get out there and kind of mess around at one of the defensive positions?
You know, I love competing. You know, I love going out there and, you know, kind of giving a chip on my shoulder and, you know, kind of telling the other guys, hey, listen, like, you know, you're not just playing for yourself, but you're playing for my team. And, you know, I like being athletic. I like staying, you know, in shape. So, you know, just going out there catching ground balls is, you know, it's fun. If it gets you, you know, ground ball back to you, you know, you always are prepared.
And we've seen you hit some ground balls with the fungo as well. I talked to Tanner Witt yesterday about him being a two-way player. Let's move Witt aside. Who is the best hitting pitcher on this team after him, in your estimation?
Well, you saw McFarland swing the bat. And, you know, he gave it a competitive at-bat, had a six-pitch at-bat, and actually put the ball in play. So I would say he's a pretty good hitter as well.
How many times did you see Alex hit when you guys were at Miami together?
Well, he actually never hit. This was his first college at bat, and I was actually very impressed. You know, they threw sliders at him, and, you know, he was able to fight, and he was able to get himself in a good count.
What was the talk like when he came back to the dugout? You guys were hooting and hollering at the top step while he was hitting.
Yeah, it was great. You know, the bullpen was out there cheering for him. You know, we, especially us as pitchers, every chance we get at the plate, it's kind of fun. You go out there and compete. So, you know, we were just rooting for him, and we were glad that he was able to put the ball in play and not strike out.
Turning to tonight's game, Adam Tulloch goes on the mound. He's been one of the aces on this team so far. What, in your estimation, makes him so effective?
You know, just like we talked before, you know, just being able to put the ball in the right spot and the right counts. I think he's not one of those electric guys, but he knows how to pitch. He knows how to get people out, and he knows how to put the ball both sides of the plate whenever he wants.
Well, we'll see if Tulloch can do that tonight. Victor, thank you so much for joining me on Catch of the Day.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you for having me.
That's Victor Brederos, right-hander from the University of Miami. We'll talk about tonight's starting pitcher and a whole lot more coming up on the Angler's Extra pregame show. Let's send it back to Emmanuel Berbari.
Yes, indeed. Tonight's starting pitcher knows how to pitch, as evidenced by Victor Medeiros' comments. Adam Tulloch takes the ball. We find out the rest of the pitching matchup, the full lineups, much more straight ahead on the Angler's Extra pregame show.
Angler's Extra. Urgent care is now available at 4 Cape Cod healthcare locations in Hyannis, Falmouth, Sandwich, and Harwich. Open after hours and weekends, staffed by ER physicians. Expert care when you need it. Learn more at capecodhealth.org/urgentcare.
And Chatham A's baseball is on the air right now.
Swings and hits one to left center field. Back goes McFadden. He will not get there. It's a home run. A grand slam for Todd Frazier.
Chugging into second base with an RBI double is Evan Longoria. He is 4-for-4.
Hit on the ground, left side. Will it get through? Off Crawford and into center field. Fedorovich scores, and Chatham wins it in 11. The game-winning hit from Seager. It's a 5-4 Chatham winner.
And now, with your play-by-play, Emmanuel Berbari and Ben Shulman.
Lights are on at an overcast Veterans Field in Chatham. Teams lining up on the first and third base sides. Chatham and Cotuit tonight. East versus West, two teams trying to snap abbreviated losing streaks, get back on the right track, back into playoff contention. Moments away from first pitch, fans filing in. And with that, we slide it across the table to public address announcer at Veterans Field, Peter Burns.
Please rise for tonight's national anthem, to be sung by Cheryl Kane. Cheryl Kane sang the national anthem at Fenway Park and Dodger Stadium, and this is her at least third trip back to Veterans Field this year. She enjoys teaching voice lessons on Zoom and in person. With tonight's national anthem, please welcome Cheryl Kane.
Oh, say can you see, by the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Always a great rendition of the national anthem by Cheryl Kane.
Set for first pitch at Veterans Field tonight. Not much wind, a calm, cool night on this late July evening. Some rain was in the forecast earlier, but forecast has significantly improved over the last couple of hours. Expect to get a full game in. Chatham and Cotuit, the Anglers at 9-14-3. The Kettleers at 11-13. Chatham has lost 3 in a row, all at home on this homestand. Cotuit has dropped 4 in a row. Chatham darting onto the field from the third base dugout, taking their respective positions. And with that, we check out the Cotuit Kettleers starting lineup. It's brought to you by the Chatham Squire.
Leading off for the Kettleers tonight, the third baseman out of Old Dominion, Carter Trice. And inning behind him, it's Dallas Baptist center fielder Jace Grady. In the three spot from Boston College, the first baseman Luke Gold. Hitting fourth, the catcher from UNC Wilmington, Matthew Suggs. Another UNC Wilmington man, the right fielder, hitting fifth, Noah Bridges. And then a Coastal Carolina shot to clear in the sixth spot, Eric Brown, the second baseman, hits sixth. He robbed a base hit for Matt Hogan last time these two teams played to save the win for the Kettleers. Hitting seventh from Florida State, the left fielder Brett Roberts, and hitting eighth, his first at-bats coming tonight, the DH from University of Texas Rio Grande Valley, Raul Ortega. Hitting ninth from Kentucky, the shortstop Ryan Ritter.
That's a Cotuit lineup that's only scored six runs total over its last four games. So, as you alluded to, Ben, some modifications. A lot of players in their first or second Cape League game tonight. They go up against the lefty Adam Tulloch for Chatham. The West Virginia Mountaineer, his second start since being drafted in the 17th round by the LA Dodgers. He still hasn't signed. He's a crafty left-hander. He takes his warm-up from the third base side of the rubber. He fires three quarters. And Ben, he's had a terrific summer on the Cape. And ultimately, he's betting on himself.
He has been drafted. He hasn't signed. Tom Holliday said in the pregame show he's picked a new school to go to next year, which doesn't mean necessarily he's staying in school. But what it does mean is either Adam Tulloch ends up in the majors by August 1st or the minors, or he's in his fourth college in 4 years.
The Anglers throw it around the infield and return the ball to the lefty Tulloch, who sports the home white uniform with script Chatham in blue across the chest, blue numerals on the back, white pants, and a blue cap. Carter Trice stepping into the righty box for Cotuit. He's in the road maroon uniform for the Kettleers with black numbering and lettering, white trimming, white pants, and a black helmet. Calm night in Chatham. Late July, lights on, overcast skies, not much wind if any. Trice measures up the lefty Tulloch in the righty box. The southpaw winds, kicks, and delivers. A fastball inside, 1-0 to start the game. Game time 7:02, temperature 75 degrees in Chatham. Time and temperature brought to you by the Chatham Athletic Association. Tulloch, the 6'2", 210-pound lefty, winds, deals a 1-0. Fastball popped up. Right field line, twisting, Hogan drifting into the corner, measures it, makes a play in fair territory for the first out of the ball game, retiring Trice, who jogs back to that Cotuit first base dugout. So a couple of pitches and one out for Tulloch, and Trice in his second Cape League game goes to 1-for-5. Just underway, no score, Chatham and Cotuit. Brings up another righty hitter, Jace Grady, the center fielder from Dallas Baptist. He's 6-for-27. First pitch, changeup, strike, outside corner, 0-1. Tulloch, no record this year, 0-1. Fastball outside, 1-1. He has an even 3 ERA. His first three appearances, 11 scoreless. His last two, 7 1/3, 6 runs, 1-1. Breaking ball, swing and a miss, 1-2. Ben, though, all of those appearances on the road, his first veterans field start.
Perhaps why he doesn't have a win, the A's have not scored much on the road.
1-2 pitch, fastball chopped over the mound, up the middle, the shortstop Rivera ranges left in one motion, fires on a hop, Midler Green picks it out at first. Smooth play by the Florida shortstop. Two up, two down for Tulloch. Grady set down by a step, two away in the first.
That's called a healthy hop. He bounced the ball maybe 5 feet in front of the first baseman, Miller Green, so that by the time it came up, it was right at the chest, like a regular throw, easy to pick.
Two quick outs for Tulloch. Third righty hitter of this top of the first inning, Luke Gold, the first baseman from Boston College. First pitch, a fastball, strike inside corner, 0-1. You heard Rivera at short. Danny Cerretti, another start, the UNC second baseman. Johnny Castagnazzi at the hot corner. At third, fellow Tar Heel, Lyle Midler-Green at first. 0-1, fastball tipped right into Romero's glove behind the plate. 0-2, Romero, the Vanderbilt catcher. And left to right in the outfield, Oklahoma State's Garrett Martin, Oklahoma State's Caden Tranquil, and Vandy's Matt Hogan. 0-2, That's ball up and away, 1-2. That defensive alignment brought to you by Short and Sweet Ice Cream. 1-2 with two down. Tulloch looking to complete a 1-2-3 in the top of the first. The lefty comes home. Breaking ball grounded wide of third and foul. Still 1-2 on Gold. Gold leads the Kettleers in homers with four. Last time, Cotuit and Chatham faced off at Lowell Park. Gold went 2-for-4 with an RBI double and a couple of runs scored. Tulloch's 1-2. Fastball drilled. Right field, not deep. Hogan camps under it a couple of steps in. Makes a play to his right side. And a quick, easy 1-2-3 top of the first inning for the West Virginia Mountaineer, Adam Tulloch. Retires Cotuit in order. Can Chatham's offense come back to life? Three straight losses at home. 4-3 last night to YD. A couple of changes in the Anglers' order to try to jumpstart Tom Holliday's team. We highlight those next. No score. Chatham and Cotuit entering the bottom of the first inning at Veterans Field. You're listening on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Sports Radio, play by play. Go A's! Chatham on GRC.
Bottom of the first inning at Veterans Field. Cotuit goes 1-2-3 in the top of the first against Adam Tulloch. It's Will Jacobson's turn, the Harvard right-hander, a rematch from 5 days ago. Two counterparts, lefty versus righty. That pitching matchup brought to you by Red Nut Bar and Grill. The Chatham lineup that faces Will Jacobson, the tall right-hander, is brought to you by the Chatham Squire.
Leading off this bottom of the first, the shortstop from Florida, Josh Rivera. He's followed by Vanderbilt right fielder Matt Hogan. In the three spot, Caden Trenkel, the center fielder from Oklahoma State. And hitting fourth from Chipola College, the first baseman Lyle Miller Green. Hitting fifth from Vanderbilt, a catcher, Max Romero Jr. And hitting sixth, the North Carolina DH, Johnny Castagnazzi. Hitting seventh, Old Dominion third baseman Kenny Lavari. Hitting eighth, McLennan College left fielder Garrett Martin. And ninth, UNC second baseman Danny Soretti.
Rivera, who you just mentioned, kicks some dirt in the righty box. Steps out, takes a practice swing. And measures up the righty Will Jacobson. 6'1", 205 pounds, an open stance from the first base side of the rubber. Goes from the stretch. First pitch, Rivera pops it foul behind the plate, 0-1. Rivera in at 240. It's taken him a while to get up to that clip. He was in the mid-100s for a majority of the Scape League season, but only two games in his last 10. Rivera didn't have a hit. He's been streaking of late. Jacobson's 0-1. Rivera looks at a fastball up and in, 1-1. Rivera, the Florida shortstop, followed by the Vandy right fielder Matt Hogan and the Oklahoma State center fielder Caden Trenkel in this bottom of the first inning. No score, Chatham Cotuit. Jacobson a chest-high set pitch. Fastball outside, 2-1 on Rivera. Jacobson faced Chatham 5 days ago. 4 2/3, 5 hits, 3 earned runs, no walks and 3 strikeouts. He gritted it out, gave Cotuit a chance. 2-1, change up, strike outside corner, 2-2 on Rivera. And Cotuit eventually rallied back. Tulloch had the better start 5 days ago. Jacobson just kept the Kettleers in the game.
After giving up early runs and an early lead to the A's, he really settled down.
A crouch down stance, 2-2 pitch. Breaking ball popped up. Right field, not deep. Bridges settles under it, makes a play at his left side. Didn't have to move much. One away in the first. Rivera set down, and it brings up the hottest angler, Matt Hogan. Jacobson is a junior from Harvard with a third of a season of collegiate experience. Less than that as a starter.
He's got a freshman arm, which is a good thing for scouts. He's not nearly as tired as a usual junior.
Deals to the lefty hitting Matt Hogan. First pitch. Fastball down low, 1-0. Fresh arm because as a freshman in that shortened COVID season in 2020, he was a third baseman and a DH. Hit over 420 in high school. Thought that was the route. The righty's 1-0. Hogan rips one to first. Diving play by Gold. On the line, gets to his feet, runs to first, and gets Hogan. Two up, two down. A sparkler from Gold at first. And he robs what would have been another extra base hit for Vanderbilt's Matt Hogan.
That was quite the play. Gold was playing 4 or 5 feet off the line because he was playing to pull, but still, he had to dive, get dirty on that white chalk, and keeps Matt Hogan, who's just such a hot hitter right now, from another double. That's a positive at bat for Matt.
Scoreless game, two outs, no one on, bottom of the first. The lefty hitting Caden Trankel in. First pitch, fastball, strike, inside corner, 0-1. Hogan is surging so hot, he's near 300 now in 16 games. Couple of homers, five RBIs, nearly a double, maybe a triple. 0-1, breaking ball down and away, 1-1. Reason I say triple is Hogan's speed.
Yeah, who knows? I mean, that was right down the right field line, and it was hooking towards the corner and could have ended up in the bullpen down the right field corner.
A ball and a strike on Trankel, who's 10 for 67. He struggled on this Cape League season. 1-1, breaking ball down and in, 2-1. Let's check out the Kettleers defense. It's brought to you by Short and Sweet Ice Cream.
On the mound is Will Jacobson from Harvard. He throws to Matthew Suggs, the UNC Wilmington catcher.
2-1 offering. Breaking ball down low, 3-1 on Trankel.
At first, Luke Gold from Boston College, and at second, Coastal Carolina's Eric Brown. In short, it's Ryan Ritter from Kentucky, and the third baseman is Carter Trice from Old Dominion. Left to right in the outfield, Florida State's Brett Roberts, Jace Grady from Dallas Baptist, and then Noah Bridges, UNC Wilmington.
3-1 is inside, and Trankel works a walk with two away. He's on board with the first base runner of the ballgame. The Anglers with two out life in the first inning. Powerful Lyle Miller-Green stepping up. Jacobson loses Trankel on his Cape League season. That's been the one issue. 7 walks in 9 innings. Throw over to first, head first line, Trankel back in safely. The first baseman, Gold, who you just mentioned, Ben, he's half holding on Trankel. He's about a foot, maybe two, in front of the bag. He's not straddling it, giving himself an extra jump with a lot of the right side of the infield open for Lyle Miller-Green. Pitch. Miller-Green takes a fastball up high. 1-0.
He's also giving Caden Trankel an extra step lead, though, because he's almost no threat to tag Trankel out.
The second baseman, Brown, is shading behind that second base bag. Short and third straightaway. No score, bottom of the first inning. Trankel on first, pitch. That's ball strike outside corner, 1-1.
And Caden's gonna get every step he can off first base because Lyle's always a threat to hit a double and Trankel wants to score in that case.
Throw over to first again. Trankel back easily with a dive, largely due to Gold's positioning.
He's like standing up by the time the tag even comes over.
From our vantage point, it looks like he's in Trankel's line. That's how far out he is. 1-1. Miller-Green takes a breaking ball outside. 2-1. It's Gold at first, and then Trankel a four-step lead off. Gold's basically at the two-step lead point in Trankel's lead.
And the way he's angled, he's facing center field. I don't know if he's actually in a better defensive position.
2-1 offering. Fastball outside, 3-1. Jacobson in danger of walking two two-out Chatham hitters. Jacobson, just like Tulloch, no record this summer. He's been effective at times, but command the issue, as was the case last time against Chatham. Another throw, Tranquil back safely, ahead of a 3-1 pitch to Miller Green. Lyle struggled of late, but the walks have not been the issue. He stayed patient. Three, one comes home. Fastball swing and a miss, 3-2. Hitters count. Miller Green looked to unload.
Trenkel's gonna be off on the pitch. Gold moves back to a regular defensive position at first.
Probably better off. The right fielder Bridges well off the line. The center fielder Grady shifts towards left center. Left fielder Roberts straight away in deep. 3-2 with two down, bottom of the first, no score. Trenkel runs, pitch. Fastball foul back, still 3-2.
Caden probably had five steps off first now. My golden rule as a very, very slow base runner when I was in high school, go out as far as the first baseman is off the line because he has to run all the way back, catch and tag you while you just have to get back.
Right, advantage base runner.
And he's still about a step behind, I think, where he could be.
Another 3-2 with two away in the bottom of the first. Tranquil, the running lead. He goes, pitch, fastball grounded softly to third. Trice to his right, throws on the run, throws high. Miller Green safe. And Tranquil goes all the way to third. On the errant throw, pulling Gold up the first baseline towards the plate. Miller Green reaches first safely. Tranquil all the way to third. Runners at the corners with two down for Chatham. It scored a hit for Lyle Miller Green.
Lyle will take a hit like that right now, because he just needs any form of hit, falling under 200 coming into the game.
Chance to capitalize for the Anglers against Will Jacobson. Max Romero digs in. The lefty hitter with a crouch down hitting stance, wide open in that lefty box. No score, bottom one. Anglers can get the early edge with a hit. First pitch to Romero, breaking ball down and in. What an out. The third baseman tries playing even with the bag. He takes some dirt, applies it to his right thigh. Short and second back, looking for a force. Runners at the corners, two down, 1-0. Change up, swing and a miss, 1-1. Romero well out in front. Romero struggled of late. He was on a bit of a tear on the road trip, but since coming home, he's racked up a lot of strikeouts. 1-1. Fastball up and away. 2-1 on Romero.
You've seen a lot of big swings from him recently, and he's a powerful hitter. He's a guy who doesn't need to swing 100%, though, in terms of power to hit the ball out of the park. Right now, he should just be looking for singles.
First and third, two down. 2-1. Romero cracks one. Deep right field. Bridges back. Looks up. Way gone. Talk about staying composed. Max Romero demolishes one to right. It's 3-0 Anglers in the bottom of the first.
Never mind. I think he should swing as hard as he can. I think that's probably a more reasonable course of action.
Same spot as Matt Hogan last night. Straightaway right field to the top of that green lawn near Depot Road in front of the firehouse. 3-0 Anglers, a 3-run blast. It's Romero's second of the summer. The righty hitter, Johnny Castagnani. First pitch, fastball grounded fair. Inside third, down the left field line. Castagnazzi, a big turnaround first. He holds right there. Roberts throws into short. And Johnny Castagnazzi joins the fun with a two-out single for the Anglers. All with two outs. And Cotuit manager Mike Roberts pays a visit. He's on the top of the rubber with Jacobson and his catcher, Matthew Suggs. Tranquil walked with two away. Miller Green, that slow chopper to third, that he beat out. Tranquil advanced to third. Romero, a long three-run homer, and now a Castagnazzi single.
hit or error that play to third base looms large right now, where Trice threw way wide of the first base bag. He had a shot there to get Miller Green. He doesn't, and it's cost his team three runs.
Long meeting for Roberts, who's notorious for this. The home plate umpire, Kevin Coughlin, is behind the mound, eyeing down this meeting. Now it finally disperses. Kevin Coughlin's the home plate umpire tonight. Tom Ryberg's at first, and at third, it's Sparky Burns. That umpire and crew brought to you by Audio Associates. 3-0 Anglers, bottom of the first inning. All with two outs, a walk, a hit, a home run, another hit. Johnny Castagnazzi stands tall at first. Creeps off the back. The lefty hitter, Kenny Lavari. Old Dominion DH. Ready for the first pitch. Change up, strike, outside corner, 0-1. Lavari's 1-for-7 in 2 starts so far. Drove in the game-tying run last night on a fielder's choice in the bottom of the 7th. 0-1. Lavari skies one, shallow left, the shortstop Ritter out, calls everyone off, makes a play to his left capside, sets down Lavari, and sets down any further trouble for the Anglers, but a 3-spot for Chatham in the bottom of the 1st. A Max Romero, 3-run home run, 3 runs, 3 hits, 1 left. Chatham 3, Cotuit nothing, through an inning of play at Veterans Field on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Chatham on TRC, Cape Cod.
Sweet Tomatoes Pizza, located right around the corner from Veterans Field at 790 Main Street in Chatham. Pick up a pie on your way to the game or grab a calzone before first pitch. The dough for their specialty pizza is rolled right before your eyes. Eat in or take out, 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. and sometimes later. Call 508-348-0200. See their full menu online at sweettomatoescapecod.com. Sweet Tomatoes, a Chatham pregame tradition.
Well, I came by your house the other day. Your mother said you went away. She said there was nothing that I could have done. There was nothing nobody could say. Now me and you, we've known each other, yeah, ever since we were 16. I wished I would have known. I wished I could have called you.
Top of the 2nd inning, under the lights at Veterans Field. Chatham 3, Cotuit nothing. Anglers looking to snap a 3-game skid. Matt Romero helping them do it. A 3-run blast down the right field line. In the bottom of the 1st inning, off Harvard's Will Jacobson. Now it's West Virginia's Adam Tulloch. It's his turn. He faces 4, 5, and 6 in the Cotuit order. Starting with the righty hitter, Matthew Suggs. Tulloch, a quick 1-2-3 in the top of the 1st. Chatham defense straight away. Tulloch peers over the right shoulder. His first pitch. Change up outside, 1-0. Well, deja vu, Ben. Anglers had a 3-0 lead last meeting against Cotuit 5 days ago. They relinquished it. 1-0. Change up down low. Tulloch falls behind Suggs. 2-0. What can they do this time at home?
Half the issue in previous games has been the pitching, giving up runs, but they need to continue scoring as well.
2-0 pitch. Fastball strike poured over right down the middle. 2-1 on the UNC Wilmington product, who's 0-2 so far in his young Cape League season. Only a 2nd Cape League game for Cotuit. That's Matthew Suggs. 2-1 offering. Fastball, swing and a miss. 90-mile-an-hour fastball, outer third, 2-2. Tulloch working quickly. He's not shaking off. Suggs buys time out of the righty box. Now he's back in. 2-2 pitch. Fastball tip foul at the plate. Still 2-2. Suggs, Noah Bridges the right fielder, and Eric Brown the 2nd baseman in this Cotuit 2nd inning. The West Virginia Mountaineer Adam Tulloch. looks in for a 2-2. Comes home. Fastball up and away. Count runs full. 3-2 on Suggs. Tulloch drafted a couple of weeks ago by the Los Angeles Dodgers in the 17th round, making his second start since. Payoff pitch. Fastball popped up. Shallow right field to second baseman Cerretti. Backpedals four steps, makes a play to his left cap side, and retires Suggs for the first out of the second inning. Tulloch is getting used to this life of making post-draft starts, awaiting a potential signing with the Dodgers, a potential entrance to the Dodgers organization. And Chatham manager Tom Holliday saying, last start looked like something was on his mind. This start, the key is clearing the mind and pitching like Adam Tulloch.
So tough, though, because he knows he's going through the biggest contract negotiations of his life.
First pitch, Noah Bridges shows bunt, pulls one right back to Tulloch. Three steps to his left off the mound, underhand flip, and gets Bridges. Two up, two down in the second inning. The lefty flash bunt didn't pull it enough. Tulloch with the athletic play, and he's retired the first five in his outing. Two down in the second inning, a 3-0 Chatham lead.
He sure looked composed there. The lefty falls off the mound to the right, but he was able to gather himself and come back to the other side of the mound to backhand it and eventually flip to first.
The Chatham third-year manager called these the craziest 20 days of Adam Tulloch's life.
No doubt.
Righty hitting, Eric Brown steps in. The lefty fires. Fastball driven, not deep. Left field, Martin stays put, makes a play above his cap. And an easy 1-2-3 inning for Adam Tulloch. He sets down Brown. He's retired the first six he's faced. 3-0 Chatham. Into the bottom of the second inning. Their best pitcher on the mound. Anglers having some fun early at Veterans Field on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Chatham on TRC, Cape Cod.
For sales and rentals of Caterpillar machinery, generators, and marine engines, visit MiltonCat.com, your area Cat dealer. Milton Cat, the Cape and Islands Caterpillar dealer, is proud to be a sponsor of the Cape Cod Baseball League.
I got so down and out in Frisco, tired of the pills and the rain. I picked up Hitty for the sunshine. I left a good thing behind. Seemed all of our love was in vain. Now my baby's coming in on the Tucson train. I come here looking for a new life, one I wouldn't have to explain. And that voice that keeps me.
Bottom of the second inning at Veterans Field. Chatham 3, Cotuit nothing. Anglers looking to snap a three-game skid. Cotuit on their own four-game losing streak. The Kettleers in some early trouble against an Anglers team that's had trouble scoring lately, but a Max Romero bomb in the first inning, a three-run blast, has Chatham riding high. The righty Will Jacobson, his second inning, faces Garrett Martin in the number eight spot in this Chatham order. Righty versus righty, first pitch. Change up down low, 1-0. Martin 1-for-2 with a hit by pitch last night. He's 2-for-9 since joining the Anglers, the McLennan Community College left fielder. Wags a bat above his right shoulder, 1-0 pitch. Martin takes a change up down low, 2-0.
Garrett's clearly got the favor of manager Tom Holliday because there are three guys, him, Britt, and DeLeo, that could fight for that spot. He's got it the most since joining the team.
2-0 offering. Fastball foul back, big swing. Puts it right over the netting behind the plate, 2-1. Martin's sporting that hazy orange bat. McLennan colors, also Oklahoma State colors. That's where he's transferring for this upcoming season. 2-1. Martin looks at a breaking ball outside. He's in the driver's seat, 3-1. Jacobson, the two-out walk in the first inning, came back to bite him. Three hits later, and a Max Romero home run, it was 3-0 Anglers. Jacobson behind, 3-1 here. He delivers. Fastball grounded right side, base hit through a vacated hole at second. Fourth hit already for the A's. Garrett Martin aboard to start the second inning. They're teeing off on Will Jacobson. That time, Ben, the second baseman Brown shaded towards the bag. And that hurt the Cavaliers.
Left a lot of space on the right side. Garrett Martin not afraid to go the other way. It was a ground ball base hit, but it was a hard hit ground ball.
Paves way for the number nine hitter tonight, Danny Cerretti, who's done a lot of mashing in the leadoff spot for the Anglers. The catcher Suggs comes out in front of home plate, relay signals to his infield. 3-0 Chatham, bottom two. Leadoff base runner, Martin, a three-step leadoff the bag. He's held on. Toss over to first, Martin backstanding. Cerretti, Ben, a 395 on base percentage. He's in the number nine spot tonight.
He's essentially a second leadoff hitter.
Bat above his right shoulder. He shows bunt. First pitch. He puts it down perfectly down the third base side. Trice charges, throws to first low, and pulls gold off the bag. Cerretti safe on the detonated bunt. Beautiful up the third baseline. It's stuck on the grass, and it's a base hit for Danny Cerretti. First and second, nobody out for the Anglers in the bottom of the second inning.
Danny Cerretti's got a habit of running an opposite banana peel. I think of a banana peel, when you hit a single and you're making the turn, you run out towards the right and then go into the line. He runs inside onto the grass, kind of cuts the angle off accidentally for Trice, the third baseman.
Trice creeps in for Josh Rivera, the leadoff hitter. Right on right. Jacobson looks the runners back, twirls off the mound. 3-0 Chatham, immediately an opportunity to lengthen that lead in this bottom of the second inning. An Anglers offense that scored 3 runs last night, 1 run the night before against Wareham, 2 runs against Harwich 3 nights ago. Throw back to second. Brown trailing, but can't get back to the bag in time. Martin's back standing. Jacobson spun off the mound, but had to throw a lollipop because no one was ready for a potential pickoff play. Third and first creep in now. Short and second. More in than they normally would be. First pitch, Rivera shows bunt. Puts it up the third base side. Foul ball picked up by the catcher Suggs. About 10 feet to the left of home plate. Outside that white chalk, 0-1 on Rivera.
First especially, Luke Gold was way in, 4 or 5 feet in on the grass. But I guess Mike Roberts was the wiser here to the fact that Rivera was trying to bunt.
Well, Ben, you mentioned it. The Anglers have taken leads off some of these teams. Most recently, Cotuit, who they're facing tonight, a 3-0 lead on the road. They haven't built on those leads. So, by all means, Chatham manager Tom Holliday looking to move these runners up.
But there's so much space now to the right side, down the line, because Gold is in.
Everyone's in on the infield. Another look back at second. Martin's back. Strange. Martin's not taking a big lead at all, and Jacobson's paying a lot of attention to him.
With the infield in, too, you're almost not worried at all if you're the runner.
0-1, Rivera shows bunt, takes a breaking ball down and away, smothered by Suggs in the lefty box, 1-1. Rivera fly to right to start the bottom of the first inning, a 3-run Chatham frame, all with 2 away, and a Max Romero 3-run home run. Getting word, it was 442 feet to right field.
That's deep.
Down the line, no less. 1-1, Rivera shows bunt, pulls back, takes down low. 2-1 on the Florida shortstop. The second baseman, Brown, who was already in, now comes and meets with his pitcher, Jacobson, who's run into a lot of early trouble in his second outing against Chatham in 5 days.
Wonder if they're discussing pickoff throws because he's the guy covering the bag right now. The issue is when Rivera bunts and the first baseman Gold comes in, Brown has to run to first base. So it's not like Martin needs to be all that worried. He can't shade that close to the bag and get back to his position.
Healthy leads at first and second. Nobody out. 3-0 Chatham, bottom two. 2-1. Rivera takes a fastball strike. No bunt attempt that time. 2-2.
And now he can't bunt.
First and third backing up a tad. Short and second way back. Still a hole on the right side of the infield. Second baseman Brown shades towards second. First and second, nobody out. Bottom two. 2-2. Breaking ball, tap foul at the plate. Rivera stays alive. Rivera adjusts the batting gloves. has the bat under his left armpit. Kicks some dirt, touches the edge of the plate in that righty box. First and second, nobody out. 3-0 Chatham, bottom of the second. Throw back to second, head first slide, Martin's back. That time Brown was ready for the throw. He was on the bag, but Martin got back rather easily.
Without the bunt being a threat anymore with two strikes, now Martin has to pay more attention to Brown.
Still a huge hole, though, on the right side of the infield. The first baseman, Gold's well off the line, anticipating a Rivera slap. He loves to do that. 2-2. Breaking ball, no bite, up high. 3-2 on Rivera. And Jacobson a pitch away from loading the bases again.
This is one of those points in the game where Chatham's either going to look back and say they blew the lead open or potentially could regret not adding on if Cotuit is able to score runs later.
Big leads at first and second. 3-2 with nobody out. Bottom two. 3-0 Chatham. The righty Jacobson. Chest high set. Pitch. Fastball ground to right side. Through the vacated hole. Into right field. Martin around third. Getting the wave. The throw from the right fielder Bridges. Cut off. To ready to third. RBI single for Josh Rivera. Goes the other way. Takes what he gets. 4-0 Chatham.
Luke Gold was shaded so far over towards second base, and yet the first baseman still wasn't off to his right enough. That's exactly where you'd want to hit that ground ball. It's now 6 hits for Chatham. There are no outs in the bottom of the second inning.
Chatham had 7 hits over the last 2 home games. They have 6 hits over the first inning plus tonight. The lefty hitter, Matt Hogan. First and third, still nobody out. Jacobson deals. Breaking ball in the dirt. Suggs makes the play, sliding into that left-hand batter's box, 1-0. Hogan hit a rope to first. Last inning, Gold made a diving play to his left, ran to the bag to deny Hogan extra bases. 4-0 Anglers looking to build. 1-0. Hogan takes a breaking ball down low. 2-0. After so much struggle on this homestand, and Chatham's 8th game in 8 days, they don't look tired through the first 2.
Use everything left in the tank before the off day here.
2-0 pitch. Hogan laces one towards the left center field gap. Roberts on the run. It's a gapper. It's one hop over the wall. It's a ground rule double for Matt Hogan. Soretti scores. Rivera to third. Matt Hogan stays hot. And it's 5-0 Chatham.
Could only deny Matt Hogan his 3rd game in a row with a double for so long. He probably should have 2 today. And that ball had a lot more carry than it looked like it did off the bat. That nearly got out of the park.
Staying composed, going to the opposite fields. A pillar for Matt Hogan, the Vanderbilt Commodore, who's thrived since entering this Chatham lineup. Second and third, still nobody out. 5-0 Anglers, bottom of the second inning. 3 in the first, 2 in the second, and Caden Trankel stepping in. Infield in, first pitch, fastball up and in. Trankel twists off the plate, 1-0. He's talking to Hogan before batting practice a couple of days ago. He said the biggest adjustment has been laying off off-speed pitches on the Cape. 1-0 pitch, breaking ball down and in, 2-0. He said he's used to fastballs and sliders, but the changeups here are next level. And when you keep that left center field approach, you can do a lot of damage. 2-0 offering. Fastball popped up behind the plate, over the netting. Two balls and a strike on Trankel. Fans treat it to a 5-0 Anglers lead, bottom of the second inning. The medal stands behind the plate, completely full. Lawn chairs nestled in right center field. 2-1. Breaking ball late. Base hit, fair ball. Down the right field line. Rivera scores. Hogan around third. He scores standing as well. Caden Trankel has a 2-run double. And Chatham has 4 second inning runs. It's 7-0 Anglers in the bottom of the second inning.
this offense was waiting to explode. They hadn't had a big showout all year. 7 runs, no outs in the second.
And that one passed a drawn in infield. But even with the infield back, a bullet off the bat of Trankel. He's on board for his second time in 2 innings. And the Anglers, with 3 in the first, 4 in the second, lead the Kettleers 7-0 in front of the home Chatham faithful that's been waiting for an outburst just like this. First pitch, Lyle Miller-Green takes the breaking ball outside, 1-0. Still Will Jacobson, the Harvard righty, who was solid against Chatham 5 days ago. Well, this will inflate the ERA. 7 runs, and he hasn't recorded an out yet in the second inning. Trankel's at second base. He has a 4-step lead. 1-0. Breaking ball in the dirt. Sugg smothers it. 2-0 on Miller-Green, whose 2-out single in the first inning allowed Chatham to open the floodgates.
With that base hit from Trankel, 8 of the 9 Chatham batters have already recorded a hit today.
Reminder, second inning. Two-oh pitch. Miller-Green grounds one to short. Ritter plays it in front of him. Advance to third. Throw to first. Miller-Green set down. The aggressive base running, though, from Trankel gets him up to 90 feet, and the Anglers can knock in their 8th run already without a hit with one away in the second.
It's not another double, but Lyle does the job there by giving Max Romero a very workable RBI opportunity.
Romero touches the edge of the plate with the blue bat. First pitch to him. Breaking ball, strike 0-1. 4 runs in the inning for Chatham. 7 runs through an inning and a third. Bottom 2, 7-0 Anglers. And Romero, who started this all with a 3-run blast in the first inning, won't have to drive in the run. It's a balk. Jacobson twitches off the back of the mound. That back left leg moved too soon. Trankel comes home to score standing, and it's 8-0 Anglers. Nothing going right for Will Jacobson.
You can hear the Anglers dugout laughing. They're like giddy children right now with 8 runs.
0-1. Romero takes a breaking ball up and away, 1-1. The Anglers all on the top step, dressed in the white with the blue caps. A lot of smiles in that third base dugout. Infield goes back. Nobody on, one away. 1-1. Breaking ball smashed. Deep right. Bridges gives it a look at the wall. Max Romero does it again. His second homer in 2 innings. It's 9-0 Chatham. What has gotten into these Chatham A's? Max Romero, greeted by his teammates at home plate. They're in shock. The Anglers, with 6 runs in the second inning, have a 9-0 lead, and Max Romero's putting on a clinic.
Who took the A's and where did they put them? This is a season high in runs scored, again, in the second inning.
Johnny Castagnazzi steps in, righty hitter, first pitch. Breaking ball, foul back, 0-1. Castagnazzi had a 2-out single in the first. Only one Angler hasn't reached base yet, and he's on deck. Kenny Lavari. He could get a chance this inning. In fact, he will, even if Castagnazzi makes out. 0-1. Breaking ball hits Castagnazzi on the back. Breaking ball, no bite. Right between the 1 and the 9 in blue on the white jersey for Castagnazzi. He just shakes it off, jogs down to first. And Kenny Lavari is the 9th batter to the plate for Chatham this inning. 6 runs in. 9-0 Anglers.
And Kenny's the only batter that doesn't have a hit yet.
He popped to short last inning.
Mind you, he's had 1 at-bat in 1 inning. So it's not like he needs to be in a hurry here.
And he ended a 3-run frame in that first inning. So it's not like anyone was scrutinizing his performance. Righty on lefty, first pitch. Breaking ball down low, 1-0.
It's just one of those days, though, where it feels like everyone's going to have a huge offensive release.
Defense straight away. Castagnazzi, a three-step leadoff first. He's held on. 1-0. Fastball foul back. Big swing from Lavari looking to get in on the fun. A ball and a strike. 9 runs on 8 hits for the Anglers already. 1 out. Bottom of the second inning. Chatham 9. Cotuit nothing. This is the most runs for the Anglers in an inning all season. 1-1. Fastball grounded right side. The leap by the pitcher Jacobson throws the second in the dirt. It's scooped. Throw back to first. Double play. Fortuitously turned. Jacobson, the pivot, the low throw. Ritter with the backhand dug it out and returned it to first to end a nightmarish inning for the Cotuit Kettleers. 6 runs for the Anglers on 5 hits and a 9-0 Anglers lead through 2 innings. Top of the third up next. Chatham having fun on the Cape Cod Baseball Network. Chatham A's on the air. Top of the third inning, and if you're just joining us, you missed a lot. 9-0 Chatham over Cotuit. The lefty Adam Tulloch in his third inning winds, kicks, and delivers. A fastball up and away, 1-0. Well, Tulloch's done his job. 6 up, 6 down for the West Virginia Mountaineer. He has a 9-run cushion, 1-0. Fastball swing and a miss. A ball and a strike on Brett Roberts, the Florida State left fielder, leading off the Cotuit third. 3 runs in the first, 6 in the second for Chatham. 1-1. Fastball foul back, 1-2. In that 6-run second inning, 3 singles, 2 doubles, and a home run. 1-2 offering. Fastball popped foul, out of play. Down the right field line, still 1-2. The home run from Max Romero, who has 2 home runs and 2 innings tonight. The Chatham catcher. 1-2. Fastball. Strike 3. Dotted outside corner. Tulloch freezes Roberts for the first out of the third. Romero's 3-run home run with 2 outs in the bottom of the first inning got Chatham off the schneid offensively. Then in the second, first pitch, breaking ball outside, 1-0 on Raul Ortega, the designated hitter in his Cape League debut. 1-0. Change up and away, 2-0. In that second inning, Chatham had already knocked out 5 hits and scored 4 runs. 2-0. Fastball up and away, 3-0 on Ortega. That was all before Romero even stepped to the plate and blasted a home run to right center. 3-0 pitch. Ortega takes a fastball strike. Low outside corner. 3-1. Ortega from the University of Texas, Rio Grande Valley. 3-1. Fastball swing and a miss, 3-2. Tulloch back in the count. Activated today for Cotuit. He's a small righty hitter against a tall lefty Tulloch. Defense straight away, one away. Top three, 9-0 Chatham. 3-2, Tulloch fires. Change up down and in. Ortega tosses the brown bat aside and jogs down to first with the first base runner of the game for the Kettleers with one away in the third. Gives way for the number nine hitter and righty hitter, Ryan Ritter, the Kentucky shortstop. One on, one out, top three. Tulloch a belt high set. Looks at first, back towards the plate pitch. Fastball inside, 1-0. Tulloch's 1-0. Fastball inside, 2-0 on Ritter, who's 12 for 51 on his Cape League season. This is 20th game, and a wise meeting for Max Romero. Climbs to the top of the third base side of the rubber. And some words of encouragement for Tulloch, who's lost his zone a little bit in this third. He has a 9-0 lead, though, to work with. Last time Chatham had 9 hits or more 5 days ago against Cotuit in the 7-6 loss. This their biggest offensive outburst of the season, though. 2-0. Fastball up and in, 3-0. Tulloch, with one more out of the zone, would walk his second consecutive batter. He flicks that ball aside to the third base dugout, requests a new one from Romero. Runner at first, one down. 3-0 pitch to the nine hitter. Fastball, strike outside corner, 3-1. Second baseman, Soretti shades towards the back. 3-1, fastball way up and away. Tulloch walks the 8 and 9 hitters for Cotuit. Two on, one out in a contactless third inning for Cotuit. Back to the top of the order, and Carter Trice. Catcher Max Romero is headed towards the third base dugout. The entire infield is going behind the mound to talk to Adam Tulloch. Looks like Romero needs help with his glove. Training staff giving him support. He hops up and heads right back behind the dish. Tulloch's first jam tonight. He retired the first 7 he faced. Gifted a 9-0 lead in the top of the third inning. 3 runs in the first, 6 in the second for Chatham. The West Virginia lefty, who's had a long road to this spot. His first Veterans Field start. 5 road appearances this season to an even 3 ERA. Dominant pitching, crafty pitching. First and second, one away. Lefty on righty, first pitch. Fastball upstairs, 1-0. He's earned his home start in front of the Chatham faithful. A couple of weeks after getting drafted by the Dodgers. 1-0. Fastball strike inside corner, a ball and a strike. Tries fly to right to start the game, his second at bat. Hasn't been smooth sailing for Tulloch to get drafted. 1-1. Fastball, big swing and a miss, 1-2. He spent 2019 at Wingate in South Carolina. Dominated there. During the pandemic-shortened 2020 season, went near home to College of Central Florida. Only 6 appearances that season. First and second, 1-out. 1-2. Change up, swing and a miss. Tulloch's second strikeout. He bounces back to Fan Trice. 2 away in the third. Runners hold first and second. 9-0 Chatham lead. Top three. And after the 2020 season at College of Central Florida, which is only 30 miles northwest of his hometown in Weston, Tulloch transferred. First pitch, fastball up and away to the righty hitter, Jace Grady, 1-0. Grady grounded to short back in the first. Two on, two out for Cotuit. Top of the third, 9-0 Chatham. Defense at normal depth. 1-0. Fastball popped up. First base side, foul ground. Tails out of play over the chain link fence and past the trees near the playground down the right field line. A ball and a strike. Tulloch transferred to West Virginia. And before going to West Virginia, kept his craft sharpened in the Texas Collegiate League during the pandemic. Played with the Tulsa Drillers under Tom Holliday. Look back at second, Tulloch's 1-1. Fastball inside, 2-1. With Tulsa, a 1-2 record, a 2.94 ERA, an excellent summer. The reason why he finished the season excellently. 14 and a third innings, 22 strikeouts, only one earned run. 2-1, fastball drilled, deep left field, Martin back at the wall, it's gone. Jace Grady turns on a 2-1 pitch and bombs a three-run shot into the left field night. It's a 9-3 Chatham lead in the third. Grady's second home run of the summer. And the 2-1-out walks from Tulloch come home to score. Katuit's first hit is a big fly. Tulloch takes a long time, comes set at the chest. The righty hitting Luke Gold steps in. First pitch, a changeup down and away, 1-0. Walks to Ortega and Ritter, the number 8 and 9 hitters. Pitch, changeup down and away, 2-0. That got Tulloch in some trouble. He rallied back to strike out the leadoff hitter Trice. Nearly worked out of the inning unscathed, but Grady puts one over the fence. 2-0, fastball foul back, 2-1. Now a 9-3 Chatham lead. Tulloch's 2-1. Fastball foul back, 2-2. And Chatham, as much of a laugher as those first two innings were, they got to be happy they scored some of those extra runs. Infield and outfield, straight away. 2-2 pitch, breaking ball popped up. Center field, not deep. Tranquil, under it, two steps to his left, makes a play, and ends the inning. But a two-out, three-run home run from Jace Grady, his second of the summer, has Cotuit on the board. 9-3 Chatham through 2.5 at Veterans Field on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Chatham A's on the air.
This is Tom Holliday from your Chatham Anglers in beautiful Cape Cod, Massachusetts. You're listening to Chatham A's Baseball with Emmanuel Berbari and Ben Shulman on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Bottom of the third inning, Tom Holliday has to feel good about where his anglers are tonight. Final game of this four-game homestand, Chatham 9, Cotuit 3. Under the lights at Veterans Field, a picture-perfect late July night, and Chatham with 9 runs on 9 hits through their first two offensive innings. And Ben, they go right back where it started this inning with the 8 and 9 hitters, Garrett Martin and Danny Cerretti. Their two singles, their small ball, started it all for Chatham last inning.
The first of 5 consecutive hits for the A's in that inning. Replicating that is difficult, but scoring again feels almost necessary because Cotuit went out and scored in the top half of the third inning.
All those runs off Harvard's Will Jacobson. And it's a Chatham Bars In call to the bullpen in this third inning. The righty Hambleton Oliver takes over. Jacobson only lasts 2 innings. He allows the 9 hits, the 9 runs. He walks 1 and does not strike out a batter tonight. Oliver on the first base side of the rubber. A tall, skinny right-hander against a righty Garrett Martin. Crouches down, righty bounce. First pitch. Breaking ball. Down and in, 1-0. Jacobson, last inning, mentioned how it all started with Martin and Cerretti. 1-0. Fastball drilled down the left field line. Foul ball just outside of that line. A ball and a strike. That inning featured those two singles, an RBI single through a vacated right side for Josh Rivera. An RBI double from Matt Hogan, a ground rule double to left center field. And a 2-run double from Caden Trankel. 1-1. Breaking ball stays up and in. 2-1. And after the 2-run double from Trankel, Lyle Midler-Green's ground ball to the left side. He got Trankel to third. And nothing was going right for Jacobson. He balked him home. Oliver's 2-1. Fastball up and in. 3-1. And when the run was balked home, he thought, hey, that's it for Chatham. They have a bunch of runs in. The bases are empty. But no. Max Romero hit his second home run in 2 innings to make it a 6-run Chatham frame. 3-1. Change up, strike, outside corner. 3-2 on Martin leading off the inning.
You're kind of surprised that Jacobson wasn't taken out of the game earlier, given how much he struggled.
Payoff. Fastball up and in. Anglers pick up right where they left off. A leadoff base runner, a leadoff walk to start the third inning. Martin's quickly down to first and gives way for the number 9 hitter, Danny Cerretti. Cerretti's bunt single made it first and second, nobody out last inning.
He put it out early, pure sacrifice, and made it down the line.
Throw over to first, Martin backstanding. The third baseman tries charged, and he was all out of sorts. A wacky sidearm throw to first that was high. Pitch, fastball up and away. 1-0 on Cerretti. Oliver has some work to do. Cotuit picked themselves up a little bit last inning against Adam Tulloch, who had set down 7 in a row to start the game. A 3-run home run from Jace Grady. It's Oliver's job to keep this a 9-3 game. 1-0. Cerretti looks at a fastball strike right down the middle, 1-1.
One of the best things about baseball, there's no timer. So Cotuit has 6 innings to come back, no matter how long it takes. Chatham needs to continue to add, even though they have 9 runs already.
1-1. Fastball grounded wide of first and foul, 1-2. 9-3 Chatham, bottom of the third. It's almost like a bottomless pit, Ben. We mentioned tacking on when they were up 3-0. Now we're mentioning tacking on when they're up 9-3. But it's true. Crazier things have happened in the Cape League this summer.
They went up 5-0 in a first inning against Harwich early in the year. And both of us kind of thought that game was over. They lost 11-6.
Pitch. Cerretti pops one foul, third base side, still 1-2. That's been the struggle for Chatham, manager Tom Holliday. It's not that they lack the ability to win. Even on this homestand, they're losing a bunch of one-run games. they're always missing something, and they haven't put that killer blow on their opponent. Ball and two strikes. Martin off first pitch. Fastball drilled into center. Sinking line drive. Grady comes on, slides, makes a play right at his chest. And fires in. Martin retreats to first, one down. Grady on an in-between liner. Came on in quickly, and Soretti set down for the first time tonight. One down. Back to the top of the Chatham order. Tom Holliday compared this Chatham season at this stage to the Rocky movies. Chatham's always missing something. Can they get off their backs and give that killer blow?
I guess it's Rocky 1, because in 2, he wins the title. I guess in 3, he loses again, but he wins it back.
Right. Rivera, pitch, breaking ball. Rivera takes outside 1-0. When Holliday first said it, I thought he was referring to the one with the Russian. But it could just as easily be Mr. T.
Clubber Lang. I was always an Apollo Creed guy. First two movies. It's just me.
1-0 with one away, runner on first, bottom three, 9-3 Chatham on top. I love the Russian bout because he has that famous quote, the "I will break you." Throw over to first. And Martin's back safely once again with a dive. And then he doesn't break him. He gets broken.
Clubber Lang, Mr. T, has a few good quotes. I don't think I should say them on the broadcast, though.
Probably wise. 1-0. Rivera looks at a breaking ball outside. 2-0. Rivera's 1-for-2. A flyout to right and an RBI single. Last inning, part of the six-run frame. Rivera had a wide-open second base hole that Cotuit vacated. And he shot one through that hole to score the first run of the inning. Has a big hole again. 2-0. Fastball foul back. 2-1.
It's an even bigger gap on the right side, because Gold wasn't holding on the runner when Rivera hit that single last time. Now he's covering the bag at least halfway for Garrett Martin leading off first.
That second inning, Ben, felt a little bit like Chatham training, climbing mountains. 2-1, breaking ball down low, 3-1. Without all the fancy equipment, without all the luxury. Six runs on six hits.
Max Romero in the back of a butcher shop, punching on beef.
Blooding his hands with two home runs in two innings. Not quite, but can make the connection. 3-1, fastball foul back, 3-2. 9-3 Anglers, bottom of the third, one on, one out. Hamilton Oliver, the new Cotuit pitcher, looking to restore order. Rivera taking a lot of time outside that righty box, fastens his right foot deep in it. Rests the bat on his right shoulder. He faces a 3-2 from the new pitcher, Oliver. Pitch, runner goes, fastball, spoiled foul. Still 3-2, right over that first base dugout.
Late reaction from Rivera shows off the bat speed to even make contact with that ball.
With the runner going, Brown, who's shading towards second, the second baseman, went even closer to second to cover on the throw. The entire right side of the infield was open for Rivera on what's a hit and run. 3-2, one out. Bottom three, another throw to first. Martin back standing. Oliver the righty, about high set. Martin at first, 3-2, he goes. Fastball foul back, bigger swing from Rivera there. Looking to hit it authoritatively. Still 3-2. When Rivera hits his back with the swing, that's when you know he's putting some oomph into it.
You rarely see anyone ever really do that. But Josh, it's a full body experience, that swing.
He had a swing like that on the home run a few nights ago, his first Cape League blast to dead center, right near the flagpole.
He might have been the first guy to go out to dead center at Veterans Field this year.
I think he was. 3-2, runner goes. Changeup, swing and a miss. Throw down to second is high. Safe at second. Martin swipes the bag. Rivera strikes out. two away in the third. Chatham has another runner in scoring position with a 9-3 lead, and they are reversing the call. Strike him out, throw him out, double play. After further confirmation from the umpires, Tom Holliday's not happy. He's out of the third base dugout, but he can be happy about this 9-3 Chatham lead. End of three at Veterans Field. The Anglers with 9 runs on 9 hits. 9 runs across the first two innings. And the Anglers feeling good. Final game of a 4-game homestand ahead of an off day. And the Anglers up by 6. Top of the fourth, straight ahead. Adam Tulloch takes the ball again for the A's. You're listening on the Cape Cod Baseball Network. Top of the fourth inning, it's a new Chatham team tonight. 9-3, the Anglers over the Kettleers at Veterans Field. In this top of the fourth, we hand over the play-by-play reins to the man to my right, Ben Shulman.
Emmanuel, it's 9-3. It's the top of the fourth inning. We might be the two most surprised people in the ballpark, but the A's are trying to end a 4-game homestand in style. Tulloch's first pitch of the fourth, fastball high, 1-0. Adam Tulloch surrendered 3 runs in the third inning on just one hit, gave up a home run after walking a pair. The 1-0. Fastball low, 2-0. But Tulloch's got plenty of room to get comfortable here with a 6-run cushion still from the Anglers. He deals to Matthew Suggs, the 2-0 pitch. Hit hard left side, a dive from LeVari, and it's passed him into left field. Cut off by Martin, the runaround's first big turn. Suggs heads back to the bag with a throwback and a check from the A's, but Suggs was in there safe. Now 2 hits in 3 batters for a Cotuit team that's trying to chip away at a large Chatham advantage.
Mentioned a timeless game. Cotuit has 6 innings to climb the mountain.
Trying to help them there at the plate, Noah Bridges from UNC Wilmington, a left-handed hitter playing right field today. Pitch to Bridges, skied in the air in the infield. Rivera backs up at short onto the grass, catches it right at the edge of the green, 1 down.
Second baseman number 2, Eric Brown.
Adam Tulloch came into tonight looking for his first decision of the season, win or loss. I mean, he wants the win. But either way, he has not picked up a decision yet this year. You wonder if he pitches well with this huge lead.
Right.
If Tom Holliday lets him go to the fifth.
Would be the first Chatham pitcher to go 5 innings this season.
First to pitch to Eric Brown. Swing and a miss. High fastball. 0-1. When the pitcher does not go 5, it's up to the official scorer to assign the win. Tulloch has not benefited from that rule so far. Left-hander sets right near the belt, looks over at first, comes home. Off speed, high, 1-1. Tulloch, a native of Toronto, Canada, by way of Westlake, Florida, moved when he was a kid for better weather. And I mean, in Florida, you can play baseball all around. I can tell you from personal experience, that's not something you can do playing baseball all year in Toronto. 1-1, line drive left center, sinking in front of Trinkle. He scoops it up off the ground, a base hit. Eric Brown reaches first base, and now a two-hit inning for the Kettleers, who are threatening once again in the fourth.
They're doing what they need to. They're getting base runners on, trailing. They're putting themselves in a situation where one swing of the bat makes this a ball game again. Last inning, they did what they had to. They got on the board, three runs. This inning, you just need base runners, and one swing will put the Kettleers back in it.
They hit a three-run homer in the top of the third. Two on right now for Brett Roberts in the top of the fourth. One out. Tulloch fires. Fastball up and away, 1-0. No runs allowed for Tulloch through his first four, make it three appearances. He's now allowed nine in his last three so far. The lefty steps off the mound. He had peeked back at second once or twice. A check on Matt Suggs, the runner who now leads off the bag and stares past Tulloch towards home plate. The pitcher looks back at Suggs and delivers. Fouled off over the netting behind home plate. The count goes to 1-2. Tulloch stares in for the sign. Sets near the belt. A deep breath. A check on the runners. The pitch. Fastball low. Two balls.
The command just isn't there the last couple of innings for Tulloch. Set up seven up, seven down to start his game because he was attacking the zone in playouts. Now everything's middle when he's in the zone.
The left-hander shuffles the ball around and delivers. High. Fastball. 3-1.
Pitch away from loading the bases. He's missing a lot. When he's in the zone, it's too fat. Doesn't have that pinpoint command.
Victor Medeiros, who came on catch of the day before the game, said that's what makes Tulloch great, his ability to work different parts of the strike zone with great accuracy. The lefty delivers. Hit hard, left side, through into left field. The runner, Suggs, is stopped at third. A quick relay from Martin keeps a run from scoring, but it's now three base hits in four batters. Cotuit has loaded the bases in the fourth inning. Adam Tulloch in all sorts of trouble. Dennis Cook peering out towards the bullpen right now. There's a right-hander getting loose for the Anglers. It's Oklahoma State's Trevor Martin. Dennis Cook calls time and struts towards the mound. 3 1/3 innings for Tulloch so far. Four hits allowed, all in the last two innings. All in the last six batters. The entire infield is in right now. A pat on Tulloch's head. He hands the ball away and walks back to the dugout. Adam Tulloch's day is over in the fourth inning. 9-3 Anglers lead. A new pitcher on for the A's. The bases are loaded in the top of the fourth, and a new hurler tries to get rid of the jam when we come back on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Chatham on TRC, Cape Cod.
Looking back.
With the gas low for Adam Tulloch, Dennis Cook refills the tank with Trevor Martin, a right-hander from Oklahoma State. It's a Chatham Bars In call to the bullpen for the 6'5" hurler who just came off his freshman season. And right now is the active ERA leader for the A's. Alongside Emmanuel Berbari, I'm Ben Shulman. It's the top of the fourth inning at Veterans Field. The A's lead 9-3 over the Kettleers, but the bases are loaded with just a single out when Martin enters the game. The right-hander stands tall on the mound, goes up against Raul Ortega, a switch hitter. Martin into the wind. He offers. Swing and a miss. Strike one. Trevor Martin going from the windup with a runner on third. He told me earlier in the year after his first appearance, because he was a starter in high school, he's just more comfortable going from the wind when he can.
And he's become a starter with the Anglers.
0-1 pitch. Fastball, strike, outside corner, 0-2.
Stuff plays up out of the pen, but Tom Holliday gave him a start a few outings ago. And he looked good. Extending it out, going full-fledged out of the wind.
Martin steps back. The 0-2 offer. Fastball low and in. 1-2. That lone start came against Wareham on July 9th. He went three innings, allowed two runs, but only one of them was earned. Helped the A's earn a tie against the Gatemen on a night they only had one hit. Martin deals. Strike three looking. Fastball catches the outside edge. Raul Ortega is down, and there are two outs in the top of the fourth.
Normally you don't say huge strikeout in a 9-3 game, but that's a big strikeout. Coming off those three hits allowed by Tulloch, the Anglers needed someone to cool the air, and Trevor Martin leaves the bases loaded for now, and he has one more batter to get.
This is a very pivotal point in the game. With the bases loaded, two outs, top of the fourth, bottom of the order, Ryan Ritter up. Martin fires to Ritter. Swing and a miss, high fastball at 94 miles per hour, 0-1.
It's 94, but it looks quicker coming out of his hand.
Well, with all that length at 6'5", he's throwing for maybe 50 feet.
He's on top of you.
The 0-1 pitch. Check swing, fastball, appeal. No swing, says Tom Ryberg at first. 1-1. It's almost like the way they describe Randy Johnson, is it felt like he was pitching on top of you. Now, Martin gives about 5 inches to Johnson, but he's a tall guy. 1-1 pitch. Fouled off right side, way out of play down the right field line. 1-2.
Not only would Martin keep this game in order for the A's, but he would save Tulloch's outing in a lot of ways. All three runners on base is responsibility.
Three hits allowed by Tulloch in four batters to start the inning. Martin came in with the bases loaded, one out. There are now two outs and a 1-2 count on Ritter. The Oklahoma State righty stares in, gets into the wind, and deals. Fouled off into the netting, right behind home plate, still 1-2. Trevor's got a chance to get some innings here, get some length with a big lead. First, he's got to get out of the fourth, though. Martin delivers the 1-2 again. Off speed, check swing, no swing. The ball rolls away from Romero as it was low in the dirt. It's 2-2. That was the first off-speed pitch the right-hander has offered so far. Does he go back to it here, or does he go with the fastball on 2-2? Martin offers. Ground ball, left side, in the hole. Rivera has it. Long throw over to first. Out! Josh Rivera in time to strand the bases loaded threat. Trevor Martin comes in with three on, and he lets nobody in. The Anglers lead 9-3 on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Chatham on TRC, Cape Cod.
Like tell you about now, baby. You know, she comes around. Just about 5 feet four. I'm from her head to the ground. You know, she comes around here. Midnight. She make her feel so good, love. She make her feel all right. And her name is G. L. Whoa. R. I. G-L-Y.
Gloria.
G-L-Y.
Gloria.
I'm gonna shout it all night.
Gloria.
I'm gonna shout it every day.
Gloria.
Bottom of the fourth inning at Veterans Field. It's the Anglers 9 and the Kettleers 3. Chatham, with its season high in run scores, goes to the plate for the fourth time. Alongside Emmanuel Berbari, I'm Ben Shulman. It's 2-3-4 for the A's. Hogan, Trinkle, Miller Green, left, right, against Hamilton Oliver in his second inning of work. Oliver ended the third inning in a bit of a clunky way. Garrett Martin was on first. He stole as Josh Rivera struck out on a 3-2 pitch. The Rivera strikeout was the second out. It was ruled that Rivera held his bat in front of the catcher Suggs, obstructing him from making a proper throw. The throw did sail way high of second. And because of that, Garrett Martin, who got in safely, was ruled out due to offensive interference. That ended the inning. It was the first inning of the game that Chatham did not score a run. What can they do here in the bottom of the fourth? Matt Hogan, with a double and nearly a second one today, leads off the inning. I think his nickname has stuck. You might have just heard someone say Matty Ice.
Crowd might pick it up a lot.
That's Matt Hogan. Up right now. Waits the first pitch. It's off speed, outside, 1-0.
He certainly earned the nickname with his play of late.
The only issue I have is it's kind of, I feel like it's Matt Ryan's nickname, and everyone right. knows it. The 1-0 pitch. Strike, outer half, 1-1.
They look a little bit similar.
I think a Patriots fan like Jake Klein, our media team assistant behind me, would say that Matty Ice isn't so clutch, though, after all.
28-3.
The 1-1 pitch. Line drive, right field, down and rolling towards the corner. Scooped up by Bridges, the right fielder. He throws long back into the infield, right to second base. It's a single for Matt Hogan, who's 2-for-3. He can't stop hitting. He had a double robbed in the first inning. Matty Ice is standing on first now with his third hard hit ball of the day.
Matty Ice is a little warm. He would be 3-for-3 if not for Gold's glove down that first baseline. And Tom Holliday just says he's someone whose energy and irk to play is showing up in results right now.
Pickoff throw. It skirts away from the first baseman, Gold. Matty Ice takes off for second, and he dives in without a throw head first. Matt Hogan is in scoring position completely by his own admission. It's an E1 on Hamilton Oliver, who bounced the ball over to the bat. Matt Hogan takes second. The former Matty Ice we were talking about is the Atlanta Falcons quarterback, Matt Ryan, for the non-football fans. Who, as Eman mentioned, 28-3, blew one of the largest playoff leads ever. Pitch to Caden Trinkle, fouled down the right field line, 0-1. Hogan in scoring position. All Trinkle needs to do is pull a ball to the right side to move over his speedy fellow outfielder to third. Trenkle taps the plate twice, spins the bat three times, and hoists it above his left shoulder. The 0-1 offering. Hit hard, right field, going back Bridges towards the track. He makes the catch, Hogan tags, and takes off for third. Long throw to the bag, it's wide and late. Hogan advances to third on a long fly ball from Caden Trenkle.
Almost an opportunity for Trenkle to hook a home run into the corner off the end of the bat, but still advances the runner with nobody out. The Anglers can add a cushion and every run of the essence in a game like this.
The A's dugout was up and congratulating Trenkle, who did his job moving the runner over. It's the little things that have made the Chatham offense better over the last few weeks, like advancing a guy from second to third with no outs. Now there's one out, Lyle Miller Green's up. First pitch, big cut and a miss, off speed, low, and he swung over it, 0-1. Hogan takes a four-step lead on the foul side off of third base. Looks towards the pitcher, Oliver, who's in the windup. The 0-1 pitch. Another cut and a miss on another low off-speed pitch. 0-2 on Miller Green. The infield for Cotuit at least halfway in. Only Luke Gold is on the edge of the grass, but everyone else has moved up on the dirt. Trying to preserve a run for Hamilton Oliver. The 0-2, swing and a miss, ball in the dirt, strike three, and a tag immediately from Suggs on the hip of Lyle Miller Green. That's a massive play by the catcher to get Lyle out and not force a throw down to first base that would give Matt Hogan a chance to go to the plate.
If he had to release the ball, Hogan would have taken off and with his speed could have easily been home, as you mentioned, Ben. But two away on a huge strikeout.
Chatham catcher up. Max Romero is hitting. First pitch to Romero. Fastball, strike, 0-1. Max has been up twice today. Both times he's left the ballpark. The first one well over 400 feet to deep right field. Then he went to right center in the second. 0-1 offering. Hit high, right field. It's deep. It is gone. A hat trick for Max Romero. The Vanderbilt catcher leaves the park for the third time today. 11-3 Anglers lead. The dugout empties for the Vanderbilt catcher, who can do no wrong tonight.
All of them tape measure blasts. Max Romero is feeling it. He'd been struggling of late, and tonight he says, this is what I'm all about.
Romero struggles no more. 11-3 Anglers, two outs. Castagnazzi at the plate. Oliver pitches. Johnny lines the ball to center field. It's looping, and it's over the head of the second baseman, Brown, onto the grass. Johnny Castagnazzi on after Max Romero hit his third homer of the night. We're in the fourth inning here. He's got time to hit six. Romero's homer has the lead for Chatham at eight. Johnny Castagnazzi has reached all three times. He just keeps doing it after home runs, so it's been slightly overlooked. The DH for Chatham leads off first base. He gets a peek over from Hamilton Oliver, who comes home to Levari. Levari drives the ball to deep right field. Grady on the run in center, and he makes the catch on the track in right center field to end the inning. Two runs for the A's on three hits. Guess who? Max Romero again, homers, and Chatham takes an 11-3 lead. It's the most runs this season for the A's, the most hits this season for the A's, and they're still up as we head to the top of the fifth inning.
Chatham on TRC, Cape Cod.
There's a place I go to when no one knows me. It's not lonely, it's a necessary thing. It's a place I made up, find out what I made of. The nights I've stayed up, counting stars and fighting sleep. Let it wash over me, I'm ready to lose my feet. Take me off to the place where one reviews life's mystery. Steady on down the line,
lose every sense of time. Take it all in and wake up, that's my part of me. Day to day I'm blind to see and find how far to go. Everybody got their reason, everybody got their way. We're just catching and releasing what builds up throughout the day. It gets into your body and it flows right through your blood. We can tell each other secrets and remember how to love. Da da dum da dum dum dum. Da dum dum dum. Da dum dum. Da da dum da dum dum dum. Da dum dum dum. Da dum dum.
It's Max Romero's world right now, and we're just all living in it. Top of the fifth inning here at Veterans Field. The Anglers are up 11-3. They added on last inning due to Romero's third homer of the game. We're in the fifth. Max Romero settles down behind the plate. He's on defense now. Flashes the signs to Trevor Martin, who takes on the top of the order. First pitch to Trice. Fastball high and in, 1-0. The batter is the Old Dominion third baseman, Carter Trice. Martin came on last inning, the pitcher for Chatham, struck out one batter, got a ground out to escape a bases loaded threat. The 1-0, foul tip, fastball, strike, 1-1. Martin tries to add to his team leading ERA. The 1-1 offering. Popped up, foul, over the netting behind home plate, 1-2. Martin came into this game with 8 2/3 innings and ERA just above 2. For a Chatham team that's second last in the league in team ERA, he's also helping his teammates out right now by continuing to get outs. He's got nobody out yet in the top of the fifth inning, but a one ball, two strike count on Carter Trice. The 6'5" right-hander. Into the wind, offers, strike three. Fastball dotted, high and away corner. Second time that Martin has got someone looking in the first three batters he's faced. One down, top of the fifth inning. Now it's a left-handed hitter, Jace Grady up. Martin's offering, fastball, strike at the knees, 0-1. Jace Grady's a switch hitter, but he bats from the left side against the right-hander Trice. From the right side, he hit a home run in the third inning. 0-1 to Grady. Big swing, foul ball straight back into the netting, 0-2. Martin delivered at 95 miles per hour on that fastball, and Grady just missed it, getting under him. Trevor Martin with a chance to record another strikeout to start the fifth. Nobody on, one out. No balls and two strikes. The Oklahoma State righty fires. Ground ball up the middle over Martin and into center field. Danny Ceretti gave chase from second base, but couldn't get his glove on the ball running to the right. It's a base hit for Jace Grady, his second of the day. With Grady the only runner on, Luke Gold steps up to the plate. If Cotuit's going to get back into this game, trailing 11-3, Gold's got to be contributing on offense. He's 0-2 so far. First pitch to the first baseman. Fastball inside, 1-0. Gold comes into this game as the home run, batting average, and RBI leader for Cotuit. He's got the Kettleers Triple Crown right now. He awaits a 1-0. Line drive, foul, left side. It stayed in the air about halfway up the third base line before rolling towards the fence. 1-1. Gold checks his swing, stares out at Trevor Martin. The Chatham pitcher, Martin, is in the set. He comes home. Off speed, low, 2-1. A check swing from Gold there, but he didn't bite on the slider, down and away. Martin retired the first three. Now he works with a runner on. He's in the stretch for the first time today. Deals the 2-1. Fastball just outside, 3-1. The Chatham dugout had reacted, multiple guys saying good pitch, thinking that it would be a strike, but Kevin Coughlin, the home plate umpire, did not oblige. Trying to avoid a second straight base runner. Martin peers over his left shoulder at first, now delivers to the plate, hit hard at short. Taylor May, double play ball, off to second, Cerretti back foot to first, out! Danny Cerretti falling down, makes a sidearm throw, and gets the runner by a step. No runs on one hit, no errors, nobody left on. We're halfway through the game, and Chatham leads 11-3 on TRZ Team Line.
Cape's leader, sports radio, play by play.
Go A's!
Chatham on TRC, Cape Cod.
Oh, we're halfway there.
Oh,
give me all a prayer.
Take my hand, we'll make it, I swear.
Oh, give me all a prayer.
Bottom of the fifth inning at Veterans Field, Chatham 11, Cotuit 3. Garrett Martin leads off, 8-9-1 for the A's. First pitch to Martin. Fouled back into the netting, 0-1. Martin today, 1-for-1 with a hit and a run scored. He also walked. Chatham bars in, called to the bullpen to start this inning. It's the right-hander Trevor Kunkel from George Washington. Kunkel, like uncle with a K.
Comes on for Hamilton Oliver. A couple of great names in these middle innings for Cotuit.
Brief mound visit to Kunkel. Now he's ready and gets into the wind for the 0-1 to Garrett Martin. Fastball up and in, tipped off of Martin. That's a hit by pitch, and Garrett Martin heads down to first base. We're in the fifth inning, and it's time for Major League Baseball scores, brought to you by Chatham Bars Inn, New England's premier oceanfront resort. Eman, what's up?
Well, starting with a rivalry game, middle of the second inning, Cardinals hosting the Cubs. No score between those East Division foes.
Danny Cerretti at the plate. Kunkel picks off. Martin back standing.
Rare night off for Chris Bryant for the Cubs. Chatham 2011.
Could he be traded, perhaps? Who knows?
Speculation.
Pitch to Soretti. Fastball, strike on the low and away corner, 0-1.
Kansas City, winners today, 6-3 over Milwaukee. Whit Merrifield, two-time Chatham A, 2-for-5 in the leadoff spot.
The 0-1 to Soretti, tipped into the glove, 0-2. Whit just continues to hit. He's a guy that there have been some soft rumors on floating around to get traded.
It's crazy to ever envision him not a Royal.
It's been such a staple there for the last half decade. The 0-2. Strike three looking. Fastball catches the zone. Soretti goes down. First out for Trevor Kunkel.
Another final and another successful day for a former Chatham A. D-back 6, Pirates 4. Jacob Stallings, a 2-for-4 night for Pittsburgh.
It's been such a strong year for the Pittsburgh catcher. It's the Chatham shortstop up right now, Josh Rivera, as we move back to the top of the order. Pitch to Rivera. Fastball, strike at the knees, 0-1.
Phillies, Yankees tied at 2 in the Bronx in the bottom of the fourth inning. No Andrew Knapp for the Phillies tonight. JT Realmuto, though, has scored one of Phillies' two runs.
The 0-1 pitch. Rivera jackknifes out of the way, but it's a called strike on the inner half, 0-2. Shortstop from Florida down right now in the count against Trevor Kunkel with a runner on first, one out, and an 11-3 Chatham lead. The 0-2. Hit high and deep to right field. Bridges back to the track, makes the catch on a line, spins and fires to first. But Garrett Martin gets back safely. Second out of the inning on that hard hit ball to the right field wall. Rivera goes down.
Padres over the Braves, 5-4, bottom five. That's in a delay. Indians and Astros scoreless top three. Rivalry game later tonight, Giants-Dodgers at 10 o'clock.
Yesterday, a Dodger and former A, Josiah Gray, made his MLB debut. He did give up 4 runs in 4 innings, but he struck out 7. Matt Hogan at the plate. Kunkel pitches. Hogan fouls it back into the netting, 0-1. Gray, a 2007 Chatham A, who spent his college career at D2 Lemoyne in Syracuse, New York, and got drafted out of Lemoyne very high to the Dodgers. Rather, to the Cincinnati Reds. The 0-1 pitch, outside 1-1. He was then dealt to the Dodgers. A former second-round pick, made his first career appearance. Those MLB scores once again brought to you by Chatham Bars Inn, New England's premier oceanfront resort. 1-1 on Hogan, 2 outs. Pickoff throw, Garrett Martin gets back to first. Hogan is 2-for-3 today. Doubled in the second, singled in the fourth, and scored on a Max Romero home run. The 1-1 popped out of the glove of the catcher Suggs, and back to the backstop, Martin jogs up to second base and rounds. It was a fastball high and away. Suggs got up, Statue of Liberty'd his hand over to the left, but couldn't squeeze the baseball.
Hey, short and sweet, come on, kid.
Tom Holliday telling Matt Hogan to keep a short and sweet swing, not short and sweet ice cream, who sponsor our defensive alignment, but you can get that after the game. The 2-1 to Hogan. Big swing, he fouled it off the glove of the catcher Suggs. It rolls to the backstop, 2-2. Hogan steps back into the box. If he can reach, Caden Trenkel is up next, who has also reached in 2 of his 3 plate appearances. First, the 2-2 to Hogan. Off speed, low and away, 3-2. Hogan laid off a changeup that was tumbling away from the left-handed hitter. Runner on second, full count, 2 outs, 11-3 Anglers. The pitch. Hogan wastes it as he fouls it off to the left side, out of play, and into the Red Nun parking lot beyond the left field bullpen. It's still 3-2. With every hit, Matt Hogan either makes a case to get more playing time at Vanderbilt or potentially to a new school. Tom Holliday mentioned in the manager's show he's thinking about transferring. The 3-2 to Hogan, skied high to shallow left field. The shortstop Ritter goes out. He's called off by Roberts, who drops the ball. Hogan up to second. Martin scores. Brett Roberts made a late signal and watched it carom off his arm and onto the outfield grass.
When you're hot, those things happen.
Well, he had a hit taken away from him in the first inning. He roped a ball down the right field line. And on a hop, it was stabbed by Luke Gold. So he gets one back, in a way. A two-base error from the left fielder, Brett Roberts. Scores another Chatham run. Anglers 12, Kettleers 3. Caden Trenkel at the plate with two outs. First pitch. Fastball, strike, 0-1.
That's a leveling of fortune that makes your head hit the pillow better at night. Hogan's going to sleep well.
He's reached three times. He stands on second base. He scored the previous two times he was on. Kunkel looks back at him, and now the pitcher goes home. Fastball, low, 1-1. The A's have shattered their most runs scored in a game tonight. They put up 8 against YD to start the three-game road trip about a week ago. They have 12. Here in the fifth inning, the 1-1 pitch. Fouled off, left side, out of play, over the netting. It's 1-2. One ball, two strikes on Caden Trenkel. An unearned run in on Trevor Kunkel, the pitcher for Cotuit, in his first inning of work. For Kunkel, this is just his second appearance of the season. The pitcher sets right near the chin, looks back, looks forward, fires. Strike three looking. A fastball catches the top of the zone. Caden Trenkel goes down to end the bottom of the fifth. Chatham scores one on no hits, one error, and leaves one on base. We go to the top of the sixth on the Cape Cod Baseball Network. By far their best offensive showing of the year. Now hand the bats over to Cotuit. They lead off the inning 4-5-6 with Matthew Suggs. First pitch to Suggs, off speed, at the knees strike, 0-1. The catcher was frozen by that slider from Trevor Martin, who's in his third inning of work for the Anglers. 6'5" right-hander from Oklahoma State. Steps back into the wind, kicks and offers. Off speed again, check swing in the dirt. Appeal to first, swing, says Tom Ryberg, the first base umpire. Now it's no balls and two strikes on the batter, Matthew Suggs. Martin with a pair of strikeouts tonight, one in the fourth and one in the fifth. He starts the sixth inning off 0-2. Martin comes home. Fastball high, 1-2. First time he went with the heater in this at-bat. He was at 92 miles per hour, which is a little below what you'd expect from Martin. He's more of a 93 to 95 guy. Here's the 1-2 pitch. Swing and a miss, strike three. 92 again with the fastball. This time it works. And Matthew Suggs goes down swinging to start the sixth.
The right fielder, number 20, Noah Bridges.
One out, nobody on. Anglers 12, which I can't say enough tonight. Anglers 12, Kettleers 3. At the plate, Noah Bridges, the right fielder. Trevor Martin into the wind, delivers, off speed, just low, 1-0. Chatham's up 12-3. We'll check out everything else that's going on in the Cape League. Scores brought to you by Sweet Tomatoes Pizza.
Well, the Harwich Mariners scored a lot of runs today as well.
The 1-0 pitch, swing and a miss, low fastball, 1-1.
They beat the Whitey Red Sox at Red Wilson Field 11-1 in seven innings due to darkness.
It's a big win for the second-place team in the East over the third-place team in the East. Harwich building a bigger lead for a playoff spot. The 1-1. Off speed, slider at the knees, catches the zone. 1-2.
In progress, Falmouth leads Bourne in a West Division matchup at Doran Park. A lead for the Commodores. 3-1 top eight.
Martin's 1-2 to Bridges. Swing and a miss, strike three. 94 mile per hour fastball at the top of the zone. Back-to-back strikeouts on UNC Wilmington batters. Two down.
Bottom of the sixth inning, Orleans over Brewster. 5-0 at Eldridge Park. The first place Whitecaps trailing tonight.
On one hand, that's good for Chatham because they're trying to catch the teams in the top two spots. But they also want to jump Orleans, who's in fourth right now in point percentage in the East. Chatham is in fifth. Third batter of the inning, Eric Brown. First pitch to the second baseman. A slider low, 1-0.
One more final. Hyannis stays hot. 5-4 win over Wareham.
That's 3 out of 4.
Hey, 5 wins now.
The Harbor Hawks are on a heater. 1-0 pitch from Martin. Off speed, just inside, 2-0.
Never did I think a week ago we'd be saying the 5-win Hyannis Harbor Hawks.
For Wareham, they had lost 6 in a row, then they mollywopped the Anglers and pounded Hyannis yesterday, coming back to earth. 2-0 pitch, fastball, lower part of the zone for a strike, 2-1. Back-to-back strikeouts to start the inning for Trevor Martin. He's down 2 balls and 1 strike to Eric Brown, a right-handed hitter. 2-1 offering. Check swing, called strike. Fastball at the knees, 2-2. Can Martin end the sixth inning in style? He waits for Brown to get back in the box. Staying perfectly still, the 6'5" right-hander with a little nod on the pitch gets into the one. The 2-2 ahead. Fastball, low and away, 3-2. Nobody on, full count, 2 outs, top of the sixth. Anglers 12, Kettleers 3 in the final game of this 4-game homestand. Time called by Eric Brown. Those Cape League scores once again brought to you by Sweet Tomatoes Pizza. A chance for Chatham to gain on the East Division leaders in Brewster, who lost today. Martin's payoff pitch. Swing and a miss. Trevor Martin sets down the side. Three strikeouts in a row to end the top of the sixth inning. Nothing across for Cotuit. Top six. What can Chatham do in the bottom of the sixth? We find out next on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
This is former Orleans Cardinal Aaron Boone, and you're listening to Chatham A's Baseball with Emmanuel Berbari and Ben Shulman on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Chatham bars in call to the bullpen to start the bottom of the sixth. GW's Trevor Kunkel is out. GW's Harrison Cohen is in.
Colonials.
It's a big A-10 showing.
It is. A-10 strong.
Alongside Fordham graduate and A-10 member Emmanuel Berbari, I'm Ben Shulman.
A little shameless plug, despite, you know, Atlantic 10 being a stretch given my lack of athletic prowess.
As I was saying it, I was thinking, if someone ever called me an ACC member.
Right. Outrageous.
Oh, my gosh. Something else that's outrageous, the Anglers are up 12-3 right now on Cotuit, holding their largest lead of the season with their most runs scored of the season, 12 hits, their most hits of the season. And we're just in the bottom of the sixth inning. 4-5-6 for the A's. Lyle Miller-Green, Max Romero Jr., Johnny Castagnazzi. And while there's a lot of baseball left, all eyes are on Max Romero Jr., who hits second in this inning, who's 3-for-3 tonight, three home runs.
Can he hit four in four at-bats? Ben, and he'll probably have one more at-bat.
The major league record is four home runs. We just heard Aaron Boone, his Orleans Cardinals with a big win today. Now the Firebirds. Chatham being helped by Max Romero right now, trying to catch that first place team. Before we can get to Romero, Lyle Miller-Green comes up. He's 1-for-3 today. Infield single in the first, ground out in the second, strikeout in the third. Miller-Green the first to face the new pitcher, Harrison Cohen, who sports an over 7 ERA in 6 appearances. First pitch, big cut and a miss, high fastball, 0-1. Cohen sent that one in at 93 miles per hour. The GW Colonial waves the glove, looking for a new pitch. Now he's got it. He sets to the right of his face, winds and offers. Fouled off, right side, out of play. 0-2. Lyle right now in trouble. On deck behind him, Max Romero Jr. on a three home run day. Before we can get to Max, it's the 0-2 to Miller-Green. Swing and a miss, strike three. Low and away off speed, Miller-Green goes down swinging for the second time tonight. The loudest applause we've heard on a walk-up introduction, I think so far this season. Max Romero Jr. gets applause from the crowd as he steps in for his fourth at-bat. Romero shrugs the left shoulder, now gets the bat above that left shoulder, and he awaits the first pitch from Cohen. Big swing, popped up high down the left field line. It's twisting foul and lands out of play beyond the dugout, 0-1. Romero went right down the right field line in the first inning, and then a pair of blasts to right center in the second and fourth. He leans back on that back left leg as he readies for the 0-1. Check swing, low pitch, 1-1. Max had four home runs in the Vanderbilt season. He now has four in the Cape League season. And it's limited action for both teams. He has flexed the home run muscle a remarkable number of times, considering the at-bats he's got.
You only wonder what he could do in a full season.
The 1-1. Strike. Off speed. Right at the knees. It's 1-2. A buzz in the crowd as the fans await what could be another big blast from Romero. The 1-2 offer. Check swing. Bounced in the dirt. Ball two.
Surprise, no appeal. Romero flailed at that pitch. No one on Cotuit had anything to say about it.
No ask from the catcher, Matthew Suggs. As Romero offered, but then pulled back at that pitch to get the count to 2-2. The lefty slugger still in the batter's box. The 2-2 ahead. Popped up on the infield. This one playable behind third base. Trice calls for it. He's called off by the shortstop, Ritter, on the outfield grass. Romero is retired for the first time tonight.
Every time he lifts a ball, you hear the oohs and ahs from the crowd as if something special about to happen. You earn that respect after a showing like Romero's had tonight.
He could strike out five more times tonight, and it would be a good day. He's now 3-for-4 with three homers. Johnny Castagnazzi up. Two outs, nobody on. The pitch. Castagnazzi lines a ball, a leap, and it's not caught by the shortstop, Ritter. He knocks it down, throws to first. Tag made by Gold, who was pulled off the bag. Castagnazzi retired. Ritter, the shortstop, leaped. Corralled it, but then dropped it as he came down to the ground. It was no catch. He spun through to first, pulled the first baseman Gold off the bag, who tagged Castagnazzi to end the inning. No runs, no hits, no errors, nobody left in the bottom of the sixth. 12-3 Chatham, top seven straight ahead.
Chatham A's on the traffic jam, staring at the faces in a rearview mirror, looking at the promise of the promised land. One kid dreams of fame and fortune, one kid helps pay.
Top of the seventh inning at Veterans Field. Anglers 12, Kettleers 3. An east-west clash heavily in favor of Chatham right now. Alongside Emmanuel Berbari, I'm Ben Shulman. For the fourth inning, Trevor Martin is on the mound. He gets 7-8-9, starting with Brett Roberts. Martin's first pitch. Fastball high, 1-0. The Oklahoma State righty came on with one out and the bases loaded in the fourth. escaped that jam and hasn't allowed a run since. The 1-0. Inside, 2-0.
The game was hanging in the balance a little bit there. 9-3. Sure, the Anglers were up by 6, but bases loaded, one down. Martin's restored order in a big way.
2-0 pitch. Hit hard up the middle, off the mound, and it rolls into center field. Brett Roberts with his second base hit of the night stands on first, a leadoff base runner in the top of the seventh. That is the second hit allowed by Martin as he's gone through 2 2/3 innings for the Anglers. Raul Ortega settles into the lefty batter's box. Nobody out, one on. Martin sets, slightly closed. First pitch, fastball, strike, 0-1. Trevor only needs one more out to match his season high in innings pitched of 3. It came in a start against Wareham on July 9th. Right-hander keeps an eye at first, now stares at home, the 0-1. Fastball just inside, 1-1. As he begins to stretch out, though, you can see the fastball velocity lowering. He just hit at 90. When he came on, he was touching 95. 1-1 pitch. Fastball, strike at 91 miles per hour. It's 1-2. He's a guy who frequented the Oklahoma State bullpen this season. Does he get an opportunity to try for a starting job next year? 1-2 pitch. Swing and a miss, strike 3. A very late half-hearted swing from Raul Ortega makes it 6 strikeouts for Trevor Martin. You know Josh Holliday, the coach for Oklahoma State and son of Anglers manager Tom Holliday, keeps an eye on what his players are doing here on the Cape. The more Martin shows an ability to have long appearances, the better chance he has to vie for a starting role in 2022. Pickoff throw to first. Roberts dives back safely. Ryan Ritter at the plate. The Kentucky Wildcat is the 9 hitter in this Cotuit order. Ritter ready for the first pitch from Martin. Lifted right field. Matt Hogan jogs towards the line, stops up right in the middle of right field, and makes the catch, 2 down. That is now a Cape season long 3 1/3 innings pitch for Trevor Martin, who's gone 1 over the minimum.
Base hit in the 5th inning, erased by a double play. Base hit this inning, the only blemish to this point, and a huge escape back in the 4th, as you alluded to, Ben.
He's continued to go longer and longer as this season went on. In his first 3 appearances, didn't surpass 2 innings pitched. Martin's offering to Carter Trice. A strike, fastball, lower half of the zone, 0-1. He's now surpassed 2 innings pitched in each of the last 3 appearances. And today he has gone the Cape League long. The towering 6'5" righty sets just above the belt. Delivers an 0-1. Grounded towards short, big hop up to the chest of Rivera. He gloves, throws to second, and that does it for the top of the 7th inning. 12-3, Chatham leads. Time to get up and move those muscles. 7th inning stretch with public address announcer Peter Burns.
One time because I forgot, but it is. It's the middle of the 7th, and we've got Ava Anderson, Olivia Anderson, Nolan Francis, Connor McGee, Emma McGallen, come on, Pete, and Jake Terrio, a Hall of Famer. Are you ready to go? All right, on 3, a 1, a 2, a 3. All right, read go. A one, a two, a three. Number 32, Zachary Fruit, is now pitching.
Cape Cod Baseball Network and the A's.
Sports Radio, play-by-play, Chatham A's on the air.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the crowd.
Bottom of the seventh inning at Veterans Field. Chatham 12, Cotuit 3. Chatham bars in, call to the bullpen. Zachary Fruit is on the mound for the Kettleers. He goes against 7-8-9, starting with Kenny LeVar. Fruit's first pitch. Fastball, low and away, 1-0. It's been quite the parade of names today for the Cotuit pitchers. First, Hamilton Oliver. Then Trevor Kunkel, then Zachary Fruit. The 1-0 pitch. Outside, 2-0.
Yeah, a pitcher who likely partook in the 1800 presidential election in Hamilton Oliver. Then you have Trevor Kunkel right after him.
I was going to say, Hamilton Oliver is a very much early settler name.
Right, 1700s.
2-0. LeVari puts a charge in a ball to deep center field. Grady on his horse towards the track. Can't make the catch. It bounces off the dirt and over the wall. Kenny LeVari had been the only angler today without a hit until now. He nearly left the park. He gets a ground rule double to center.
And then the third pitcher out of the pen was Harrison Cohen, who sounds like a constitutional convention type of name. And then Zachary Fruit. Providing the nutrition.
So what's your favorite name in the Cape League so far?
Ooh, it's a tough one.
I put you on the spot.
Give me some time.
Yeah.
Okay.
I have mine, but first, Garrett Martin's at the plate.
All right, you go first.
No outs and a runner on second. Chatham fans may not love it because he kind of stung them yesterday. I think Crew Robinson is one of the smoothest names I've ever heard. Fruit offers to Martin. Bounced in the dirt, 1-0. There was formerly a player in the Cape League named River Town. He is not in the league now. I know a good friend of both of ours, Brewster broadcaster, Johnny Gademowitz, loves Peyton Chatagnier.
Chatagnier, okay, that's fun to say.
I'm a little used to the French last names, though, so it's not as novel to me.
It doesn't flow off the tongue.
1-0 to Martin. Fouls the ball off to the right side, 1-1. Who else?
I'm looking. I am actively surfing my scorecards right here because I'm blanking on my favorite name this summer.
You know one of my favorite names in the Cape League? Born backup catcher, Peter Burns.
Not related to Veterans Field public address announcer, Peter Burns.
The 1-1 to Martin. Check swing, low, 2-1. I have to say, I've never seen the two Peter Burns in the same room before. So, I have no proof.
How about Nick Lucky?
That's a good one.
Recently with Harwich. I love Cy Nielsen, though, on Chatham.
That's a great name. 2-1 to Martin. Tipped into the glove, 2-2. The Anglers had Crosby Jones earlier in this year. He was a personal favorite name on the Anglers of mine. They nearly had a player named Scotty Scott. Scotty Scott. But he was not brought onto the team. It's 2-2 on Garrett Martin, the pitch. Bounced in the dirt, 3-2. There are some people who love names like Garrett Martin because it's a double first name. Seen a handful of those this season as well. Runner on second, Kenny Lavari. Nobody out, bottom of the seventh, 12-3, Chatham lead. Payoff to Martin. Chopped foul left side towards the Chatham third base dugout. Still 3-2. Anyone else you want to highlight before we wrap it up? Another ace killer, Briley Knight. I've never heard the first name Briley. 3-2. Fouled off the left leg of the batter, Garrett Martin, who stays alive. Pitch 8 to Martin upcoming. Garrett today has reached all three times. Single, walk, hit by pitch.
Carter Putz.
Carter Putz is a good name.
Wonder who plays golf.
3-2. Fouled off again into the netting. Still 3-2. It has a slightly different meaning for our Yiddish listeners. The many Yiddish listeners to Chatham Anglers Baseball. By the way, if you're around the country listening anywhere or around the world, email us at chathambroadcast@gmail.com.
Sure,
we'd love to hear from you.
Your favorite name?
My favorite name is Crew Robinson.
We'd love to hear from you. What's your favorite name? And
yes.
Of course, Carter Putz. You're going Yiddish. That's not a positive connotation.
No, it is not. Three and two to Garrett Martin. Strike three looking. 9 pitches to set down the McLennan College left fielder. One out in the bottom of the seventh. Danny Soretti up. One gone, Kenny Lavari on second. 9-run Anglers advantage. Zach Fruit, who spurred this name discussion, peers in towards his catcher, Matthew Suggs, and now sets below the chin. Fruit offers. Misses low and away, 1-0. Not the first time that Fruit has pitched against the Anglers this season. The 1-0 pitch, Soretti takes to left center field. Roberts on the run, and he makes the catch. Sprinting to his left, towards left center. Red Roberts with a heck of a play, 2 outs. So now 2 down, Kenny Lavari at second.
From Matty Ice to Joshy.
Was that a fan-given nickname, Joshy, you think, or a dugout-given nickname?
I think it's a dugout-given nickname. Let's go, Joshy.
They do tend to get on Rivera a lot, the Anglers. The first pitch to Josh. Down 1-0. It's all in good fun. He's, I would say, a veteran on this team, considering he's been here the whole year.
Yeah, since the first workouts. And they give it to him because he gives it to them. It goes both ways.
1-0 pitch to the shortstop. Off speed, called strike, 1-1. And Josh told you after the game when he hit his first homer, he told everyone in the dugout after he hit that homer, now they know.
Now they know.
They know about Josh Rivera, the smooth hitting shortstop. 1-1. Off speed, 1-2. Rivera struck out once today in his 1-for-4 day. Two outs, one ball, two strikes. Fruit offers, swing and a miss on a ball in the dirt. Rivera jogs down to first base. Suggs throws on the inside part of the line and ends the inning. Still a 12-3 rout for the A's. They score nothing on one hit, no errors, and strand the leadoff double from Kenny Lavari. Although at this point, it doesn't seem too consequential. Their most runs scored, their most hits, their largest lead. The A's beating up on the Kettleers at Veterans Field. They try to close it out when we come back. Two innings left on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Hi, folks, it's Red Sox radio broadcaster Joe Castiglione here to thank you for choosing Shaw's and Star Market and to let you know that Shaw's and Star Market are now proud sponsors of the Cape Cod Baseball League, where the stars of tomorrow shine tonight.
I spent 20 years trying to get out of this place. I was looking for something I couldn't replace. I was running away from the only thing I've ever known. Like a
top of the eighth at Veterans Field. Chatham leads 12-3. Two more innings to go, and for that, we turn it over to Emmanuel Berbari.
Ben, the first laugher for the Anglers this season. Most runs, most hits. 9 runs over the first two innings set the pace for the A's, and they've only tacked on, but created more notable moments. Max Romero, 3 home runs in the first 4 innings tonight. The Vanderbilt catcher, the spark plug for the A's, who go to their third pitcher. A Chatham Barzin call to the bullpen. It's a Fordham lefty, Garrett Crowley, who's been dominant so far this summer for the Anglers. Benny's on in relief of Trevor Martin, the Oklahoma State power right-hander, who was brilliant, stabilizing this game in the middle innings, allowing the Anglers to tack on. 3 2/3, 2 hits, no runs, 6 strikeouts.
It's his best performance to date for the Anglers, and he was already leading the team in ERA.
Martin continues to mow down opposing lineups. Crowley looks to do the same. The lefty, a belt high set, deals with the righty hitting Jace Grady. First pitch, a breaking ball drops up and away, 1-0. Crowley struggled at Fordham this spring. For the first time in his young collegiate career, struggled with command, an ERA in the mid-fives, but he showed what he's made of with Chatham this summer. Enters with a 9-run lead in the top of the eighth inning, his most low-leverage appearance of the summer. In 17 1/3 innings, he's allowed 15 hits, 10 runs, 5 walks, 25 strikeouts for Crowley. Sets on a 1-0 pitch, changeup down and away, 2-0. Those 10 runs, really, a couple of bad innings. One of them 5 days ago against this same Cotuit team. The Kettleers turned a 4-2 Anglers lead into an 8-4 Kettleers lead. 2-0, fastball grounded softly to short. Rivera to his left spins, can't get it out of the glove. It's in shallow center field. Rivera picks it up with the bare right hand. Grady aboard to start the eighth inning with a slow single up the middle off Garrett Crowley. Ben was talking with Crowley's father after that game, cross paths in the Lowell Park parking lot. He said that was the most proud he was of a Crowley outing because he grinded it out and still gave Chatham a chance and went 5 innings.
He went 3 after giving up all those runs. It shows a lot of mental fortitude.
First pitch, Change up inside to the righty hitting Luke Gold, who's 0 for 3. 1-0, one on, nobody out. Top of the eighth inning, 12-3, Chatham over Cotuit.
And you're going to get bombed sometimes as a pitcher. He gave up 6 hits in that inning. Mariano Rivera has given up 6 hits in an inning. It's what you do to bounce back.
Crowley looks at first, back towards the plate, comes home. Fastball tipped foul at the plate, 1-1. Chatham defense straight away. Fans remaining strong at Veterans Field. The naked eye, no one has departed the park since those 9 runs over the first 2 innings. Underneath the lights, illuminating the game. 1 ball, 2 strikes. Crowley's pitch. Change up outside, 2-2. Ben, we have a amusing email. ChathamBroadcast@gmail.com. Some listeners chiming in.
You might think I'm going to be lying. The subject line is Yiddish angler fans in Toronto. Shout out to our Yiddish angler friends in Toronto, the Starkmans, emailing in now.
Pitch. Change up outside, 3-1.
They've spent 10-plus summers on the Cape. They're longtime anglers fans. They might laugh when Carter Putz comes to the plate. And we love to have heard from them.
Glad the name discussion spurred some interaction. Yiddish baseball.
Former Chatham A, Adam Greenberg, might be able to chime in on the Yiddish angler fan discussion. The former Chicago Cub.
Meeting on the top of the rubber. Dennis Cook comes out. Stern talking to for Garrett Crowley, who's fallen behind 3-1 on Gold after falling behind Grady to lead off the inning and allowing a leadoff single. He has a 9-run lead to work with. You can only imagine what Dennis Cook was saying. Just attacked his own. Crowley's 3-1. Change up outside, walks Gold, first and second, nobody out for Cotuit to start the top of the eighth.
The catcher, number 16, Matt Suggs.
Crowley's bugaboo at Fordham this season, the walk, the hit by pitch. Hasn't been a problem on the Cape. Mentioned only the 5-17 in a third innings. First pitch, a fastball strike outside corner to the righty hitting Matthew Suggs, 0-1. Suggs is 1-for-3. Singled back in the fourth inning, was stranded as Trevor Martin came on, retired a bases loaded one out threat. Cotuit hasn't threatened since, 0-1. Change up outside, 1-1. This is their first threat since that fourth inning. First and second, nobody out, trailing by 9.
They just couldn't build any sort of momentum against Trevor Martin.
After the meeting, Crowley has located much better. 1 ball, 1 strike, the offering. Fastball, strike, outside corner. 3 consecutive dotted pitches, 1 ball, 2 strikes.
Encouragement coming from Dennis Cook with a lead this large. It's not necessarily about the results in terms of runs allowed, hits allowed, just making good pitches.
1-2. Breaking ball tapped awfully foul. Wide of third. Still 1-2. Well, the logical thing to say would be a 3-run homer doesn't hurt you here, and it doesn't. It makes it a 6-run game. But on every pitcher's mind is being as perfect as possible, especially when you're auditioning in the Cape League. 1-2. Breaking ball, strike 3. Crowley bounces back, freezes Suggs, who struck out for the second time tonight. Runners hold first and second, 1 down in the eighth.
The right fielder, number 20, Noah Bridges.
Crowley, quality on that at bat, executing front to back. First lefty hitter he faces, Noah Bridges. First and second, 1 down. Pitch, fastball, foul back. Dennis Cook ducks out of the way, right in front of that third base dugout. 0-1. 12-3 Chatham. 12 runs on 13 hits for the Anglers. Looking to snap a three-game skid. Finish the homestand. Strong, salvage it ahead of the off day. Crowley's 0-1. Fastball swinging to miss 0-2. The Anglers 9-14-3. They're 6.5 off the pace in the East Division. 4.5 out of a playoff spot, though. That's behind second place Harwich. The Mariners 12-8-4, but the Mariners did win earlier today. 0-2. Breaking ball fouled wide of first. Still 0-2. So that makes it a 5-game deficit. The A's can make it 4.5 once again with a win.
They're in a deep hole. They know that. But at this point, you just got to focus on winning every day. And if the things happen around you that need to happen around you, then it's good for the Anglers.
0-2. Breaking ball grounded to second. Soretti to his left. Doesn't throw to second. Underhand shovel to first to get Bridges by a couple of steps. Runners move up to second and third. Soretti with a smart play. Two down. Second and third for Cotuit. Anglers by 9, top 8.
If this game was a 3-run game, 4-run game, or closer, then maybe Soretti thinks about spinning around to second. But those runs on second and third, not very consequential right now.
Bridges goes to 0-for-4. Soretti hitting Eric Brown, who's 1-for-3. Singled in the fourth. Struck out his last time. First pitch from the lefty, Crowley. Breaking ball outside. 1-0. Tom Holliday telling us before the game that everyone loves to focus on wins and losses. And in a season like this for the A's, where they've been at an uphill climb all season, sometimes you have to focus on the growth. And there is some growth going on here, especially for the likes of Max Romero, a catcher who's sharpening defensively. A 3-homer night. 1-0. Fastball, line foul at the first base side. 1-1.
Baseball is a wild game. Wins and losses, first of all, don't always determine who's the best team. And at the end of the day, if everyone's getting better, a lot of these guys are going to look back at the season in a positive light, even if they don't end up winning as many games as they thought they would.
Second and third, two down. Pitch. Breaking ball, foul back. Ball, two strikes. And the Anglers still have time. While you said, Ben, it's an uphill climb over the last 13 games or so. They have time to make this a respectable season, one they can be proud of, even record-wise.
Yep, a lot of time. They go over 500 to finish the season. They'll be over 500 on the season. Any better, and they could start to threaten those top two spots.
1-2. Fastball line to right. Hogan dives, and he's got it. Saves two runs. Hogan, the lunge on the sinking liner, the sprawl, and takes it off the grass to strand two runners and save Garrett Crowley's eighth inning. 12-3 Anglers into the bottom of the eighth. No runs on a hit, no errors, two left for Cotuit. The Anglers still having fun. Bottom eight up next on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Chatham on TRC, Cape Cod.
But I'm
Bottom of the eighth inning at Veterans Field. Chatham's best night of the season. 12 runs on 13 hits, a laugher. 12-3 lead over Cotuit. Well, in these type of games, some fun is there to be had in the final innings. And Cotuit manager Mike Roberts has completely emptied the bullpen. He went through five relievers and now goes to a catcher out of Southern New Hampshire, Ryan Dio, for his first Cape League appearance on the mound. He started the season as Cotuit's bullpen catcher.
And he's pitching submarine sidearm, man.
He sets at the bell, deals to the lefty hitting Matt Hogan. Underhand pitch, fastball strike, 0-1 at 75 miles an hour.
The fans are loving it here at Veterans Field. The Bourne bullpen is hanging over the, or the Bourne dugout is hanging over the fence.
Pitch, breaking ball, ripped foul, 0-2. That looked a bit slower, but came in at 81, twisting towards the plate, and Hogan knocked it foul.
From submarine sidearm, 81 is pretty good. Major League submarine sidearmer is throwing the mid-80s.
Hogan's reached three times. A double, a single, a couple of runs knocked in. 0-2, fastball up high at 75, 1-2. Dio at a Northeast 10 school in Southern New Hampshire. Backup catcher there as well. 1-2, fastball popped up behind the plate, out of play. Still 1-2.
I've seen my handful of any 10 baseball with LeMoyne in Syracuse. And it is a very competitive conference.
He only had three at-bats this season at Southern New Hampshire in his first season. Pitch, fastball up and in, 2-2 on Hogan. Dio sets, belt high, 2-2. Hogan takes a fastball up and away, 3-2. Couple of pinch hitters on deck for Chatham. With some implications on what could come this inning. 3-2. Fastball swing and a miss, 77 miles an hour past Matt Hogan, who has a grin on his face as he walks back to the third base dugout. One up, one down for the bullpen catcher, Ryan Dio. One down in the bottom of the eighth.
Matt Hogan has hit everyone that they've thrown at him tonight, except the former bullpen catcher, submarine sidearmer Dio.
Pinch hitter Jake DeLeo in the righty box. First pitch, fastball upstairs, 1-0 from the sidearm thrower. Sidearm generous, a little bit lower than sidearm. DeLeo, the Georgia Tech Yellow Jacket, didn't start tonight. He's on for Caden Trenkel, who's 1-for-3 with a two-run double. 1-0. Fastball up high, 2-0. David Mendham's on deck to pinch hit for Lyle Miller Green. You wonder, if a base runner gets on, would Max Romero bat in that number five spot? He has three home runs tonight for Chatham. 2-0. Fastball low, 3-0. If DeLeo walks, that would make that question much more prevalent.
Romero was standing on the top step. He just grabbed his helmet.
He's in the hole for Chatham. 3-0. Fastball strike right down the middle at 74. 3-1. It's 12-3 Anglers. Bottom of the eighth inning, if you're wondering why things have gotten a little loose here. A bullpen catcher for Cotuit, Ryan Dio from Southern New Hampshire, is in. He's pitching. He's a right-hander going submarine. 3-1. Fastball cued foul, wide of first. 3-2, DeLeo well out in front. Full count.
He has been signed as a catcher to the roster because Cotuit lost a league-high 10 players to the MLB draft.
Part of the reason they've struggled with four straight losses entering tonight and only six runs total in those four losses. Dio steps off the back of the mound. One out, no one on in the bottom of the eighth inning. Full count on DeLeo.
Well, Dio's got a sophisticated game plan. He's got to get off and think about how he wants to attack DeLeo.
Payoff, foul back, still 3-2. If someone gets on As you mentioned, Ben, with Romero coming out with the shin guards on, taking some practice swings, he could get up with a chance for a fourth home run. He had three home runs in four innings to start his night. All of them tape measure blasts. Dio's payoff. Fastball up high. The Dio-DeLeo battle goes away the Georgia Tech Yellow Jacket. He jogs down to first with a pinch hit walk. And David Mendham, the South Carolina Gamecock, steps in. Unless there's a double play, Max Romero would get up with a chance for a fourth dinger.
And this is likely his last chance, because Chatham won't bat in the bottom of the ninth if they're still leading, and they're up nine right now.
Righty on lefty pitch. Mendham takes a fastball up and away, 1-0. Dio sitting 73-76 with the fastball. I'm not sure if there's been off speed, because a pitch looked like a slider, but it's coming from the side. 1-0. Mendham pops one up behind the plate, foul. 1-1. 12-3 Chatham, bottom eight.
Luke Gold, the first baseman for Cotuit, is doing something brave that I wouldn't do. Playing in on the grass as a submarine side armor delivers to a left-handed hitter. Mendham could rip a ball right there.
1-1. Fastball outside, 2-1. This is the most favorable matchup for a lefty hitter. A guy going sidearm, you see the ball all the way through, and it's coming in slow.
And when it's submarine, it's rising up to the plate. So you just got to add on, keep lifting it in the air.
Pitch, fastball strike. 2-2 on Mendham. Now on a little extra juice at 76.
You imagine if Mendham hits a ground ball, he's going to do everything he can to get to first base to give his teammate Max Romero a chance for another home run.
Wide lead for DeLeo at first. Pitch. Fastball outside, 3-2. It's such a wide lead that, as you mentioned, Ben, the first baseman goal playing in is playing in front of the runner. They're shadowing each other.
He's living dangerously. He's making first base the hot corner as well.
Rest of the infield at normal depth. 3-2 from submarine. Fastball popped up. On the infield, first base side, the second baseman Brown backpedals. On the infield, dirt makes the play. Two down, and Mendham secures another at bat for Max Romero. The ovation for Romero, who in his first three at-bats hit three homers and drove in six runs. Won a 430-foot blast down the right field line. Another one to deep right center. Another to dead center. Runner on first, two down, bottom eight. Pitch. Fastball strike at 77, 0-1. Romero, bat above his right shoulder. Dio's pitch. Fastball up and away, 1-1. If Romero can size up Dio, the submarine thrower, and position player out of the pen for Cotuit, he could have his fourth home run tonight.
Oh, Romo, let's go, baby.
Pitch. Romero grounds it foul, wide of first, 1-2. Dio deceptive.
Well, you would imagine Romero's taking home run cuts. So Dio coming in slower might actually be helpful, because Romero could be overeager.
Might have to go left center. 1-2, two down, bottom eight. 1-2, breaking ball, swing and a miss. 63 miles an hour, and Romero denied his fourth homer. How about Ryan Dio, formerly a bullpen catcher, retires aside with only one walk in the bottom of the eighth. Top of the ninth coming up. Anglers don't play to run off Dio, but they have a 12-3 lead at Veterans Field into the top of the ninth on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Chatham on TRC, Cape Cod.
I'm gonna wait till the
Top of the ninth inning, all anglers tonight. 12-3 Chatham over Cotuit. Garrett Crowley's second inning of relief, the Fordham lefty. Deals to 7-8-9 in the Cotuit order, looking to lock down an angler's win to wrap up the homestand. First pitch, fastball fouled right at the plate, 0-1. Roberts has singled his last two at-bats. He's 2-for-3. Crowley put two on, nobody out in the eighth inning, but promptly retired the threat. Pitch, fastball foul back, 0-2. Struck out, Matthew Suggs looking. Induced a ground ball from Noah Bridges and a fly ball from Eric Brown. 4, 5, and 6, set down. Still 12-3 anglers in the top of the ninth. Max Romero's three homer night leading the charge for Chatham. Three runs in the first, six in the second to take an early 9-0 lead. 0-2, fastball just misses inside. 1-2 on Roberts. The anglers out of two in the fourth, one in the fifth. All three Cotuit runs coming in the third inning on a Jace Grady three-run bomb. Crowley's 1-2. Fastball grounded softly to second, Soretti charges, throws to first, and records the first out of the ninth. Roberts down by two steps. One up, one down for Crowley, looking to close this out. The putout made at first by David Mendham. He's the new first baseman for Chatham, the South Carolina Gamecock. Pinch hit for Lyle Miller-Green last inning. Dominic Temez replaces the aforementioned Romero behind the plate. Crowley's first pitch. Fastball up and away, 1-0 on Raul Ortega, the righty hitter, who's 0-for-2 with a walk. Nobody on, one away, top nine, 12-3 Chatham. Crowley's 1-0. Fastball driven into center field, not deep. The new center fielder, Jake DeLeo, camps under it. Makes a play, didn't have to move. Two up, two down for Crowley. And the Georgia Tech Yellow Jacket in center field completes the defensive changes for the Anglers in this top of the ninth inning. Two up, two down, Anglers and out away. The lefty Garrett Crowley, a belt high set with the defense straight away. The nine hitter Ryan Ritter steps in. First pitch, the righty fouls it back, 0-1. An off day tomorrow for Chatham. Can complete the homestand in style. 0-1. Change up, swing and a miss, 0-2. Crowley and the Anglers a strike away. Ritter's 0-for-2 with a walk tonight. Last man standing for Cotuit. Crowley can complete the Anglers' best night of the season in front of the home fans at Veterans Field. 0-2 with two down, the pitch. Change up outside, 1-2. Crowley, the third Angler pitcher. Tulloch started. Martin pitched the middle innings. Now it's the Fordham lefty. 1-2 with two down. The offering. Breaking ball popped up. Shallow center. The shortstop Rivera out. Makes an over-the-shoulder play to end the ball game. Rivera five steps out. Hauls it in. Chatham wins 12-3. A perfect way to end a preposterous night for the Angler offense. Chatham 12, Cotuit 3 at Veterans Field. The Anglers Extra Post Game Show straight ahead. The Anglers with 12 runs on 13 hits, their first win over the Kettleers this season. They snap a three-game losing streak, going to the off day on the right foot. We'll have post-game highlights, Ben Starr of the game down on the field, much more on the Anglers Extra Post Game Show on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Hi, this is Austin Vernon from North Carolina Central University. You're listening to Chatham A's Baseball with Emmanuel Berbari and Ben Shulman on the Cape Cod Baseball Network.
Welcome into the Angler's Extra Post Game Show. It's brought to you by Chatham Bars Inn, New England's premier oceanfront resort. 12-3 win for the Anglers. Their most runs, their most hits tonight. Behind Max Romero's three-homer night, the Vanderbilt catcher with a historic showing for the Veterans Field faithful. And the Anglers finish this homestand on the right foot after three straight losses. They go into the off day riding high. 9 runs across the first two innings, a 6-run second inning, the key for the A's. And three pitchers got it done. Adam Tulloch, Trevor Martin, and Garrett Crowley. A 12-3 Chatham win. 12 runs on 13 hits, no errors for the Anglers. The Kettleers lose their fifth straight. 3 runs, 7 hits, and 2 errors. We'll hear from Ben Starr, the game down on the field. Go through the post-game highlights right here on the Cape Cod Baseball Network. The Anglers ambushed the Kettleers early. They didn't look back. They charged front to back. And when the Kettleers threatened in the third inning with a Jace Grady 3-run blast, the A's shrugged it off. 2 runs in the fourth, 2 runs in the fifth, and a 12-3 A's win. Their best of the season, their most torrent offensive performance. Ben Shulman getting ready down on the field with his star of the game. I have a decent idea of who it may be. We shoot it down to Ben Shulman as the Anglers Extra Post Game Show rolls on.
Here with Max Romero on the field following Chatham's 12-3 rout of Cotuit. Max, what are your immediate thoughts following the game?
I think the guys did a great job tonight with the way they swung it. I think Tully did really good with the way he threw. You know, at the end, kind of got a little rattled, but hey, we got right back to it, which was really good. And I thought every pitcher that came behind him just followed really well. Overall, I think the bats came alive tonight. I think that Josh hit the ball really hard, didn't show for it, but he hit it really hard tonight. And a lot of guys really screwed up the ball today.
It showed for you tonight, Max. You hit 3 home runs in 4 innings. Where does that compare to the best games you've ever had in your baseball career?
Don't really know many of those, but it's definitely a blessing to be able to do something like that, something crazy. But, just got a big thanks to God. That's all I can really say.
You tied the Cape League record with 3 home runs in a game. How do you feel about that?
Like I said again, just really grateful and thankful to God to even put me in this position.
So the game is over. Once I let you go, who's the first phone call or text message you're going to make about this game?
I call my parents all the time after every game, so why change it now?
What do your parents mean to you in the scope of your baseball career?
Everything. They're the reason I do it, so I'm happy to be able to do this today.
Max, congratulations on the big game and the big Anglers victory. Three home runs for you, 12-3 win over Cotuit.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
That is Vanderbilt catcher Max Romero, the Cape League record holder in home runs in a game. He smashed three tonight. To help the A's win, let's send it back upstairs to Emmanuel Berbari as the Anglers Extra postgame show continues.
Ben Romero ties a record held by few. Eight other times, a Cape League hitter has gone deep three times in a single game. Most recently happened in 2011. Frank Thomas with Orleans did it in 1988, 1983 by Bob Larimer with Chatham. But another veterans field showing for the record books tonight from the Vanderbilt catcher who's really springboarded this Chatham offense since joining the fold. Let's check out the highlights brought to you by the Chatham Athletic Association. In the first inning, two out, nobody on, and the Anglers went off to the races. Jake DeLeo walk, Lyle Miller-Green single, Max Romero stepped up to the plate and put a charge in what would be the first of many for the Veterans Field faithful tonight. First and third, two down. 2-1, Romero cracks one. Deep right field, bridges back, looks up, way gone. Talk about staying composed. Max Romero demolishes one to right. It's 3-0 Anglers in the bottom of the first. And he would not stop there. The Anglers would just keep pushing and pushing as a collective unit into the second inning against Harvard's Will Jacobson, who looked to weather that early storm. The Anglers with the 8-9 hitters put two on with nobody out. Garrett Martin, a single. Danny Ceretti, a bunt single. And then Josh Rivera stepped in, worked a long at-bat, and he started what would be the first of a lot of Anglers' hits in a huge second inning. Big leads at first and second. 3-2 with nobody out, bottom two, 3-0 Chatham. The righty Jacobson, chest high set, pitch, fastball ground to right side, through the vacated hole, into right field. Martin around third, getting the wave, the throw from the right fielder Bridges, cut off, Ceretti to third. RBI single for Josh Rivera. Goes the other way, takes what he gets. 4-0 Chatham. 4-0 Chatham, they would not look back. They would continue piecing together hits. Five straight hits to start the second inning for the Anglers. And it wasn't only one Vanderbilt Commodore who provided a spark tonight. Matt Hogan continued to do his thing. 2-0 pitch. Hogan laces one towards the left center field gap. Roberts on the run. It's a gapper. It's one hop over the wall. It's a ground rule double for Matt Hogan. Ceretti scores. Rivera to third. Matt Hogan stays hot, and it's 5-0 Chatham. Staying hot, he did, and the Anglers just didn't know how to get the fire off their feet. In that second inning, Caden Trankel stepped in right after Hogan with two on, still nobody out, and the Oklahoma State Cowboy drilled a ball. 2-1. Breaking ball laced. Base hit, fair ball down the right field line. Rivera scores. Hogan around third. He scores standing as well. Caden Trankel has a two-run double, and Chatham has four second-inning runs. It's 7-0 Anglers in the bottom of the second inning. Caden Trankel continued an offensive barrage that was unlike anything the Veterans Field faithful has seen this season. Chatham collectively has seen this season, and Trankel would eventually come around to score in a different, more unique way. He advanced to third on a Lyle Miller-Green wild pitch during his at-bat, and Miller-Green just had to keep the bat on his shoulder. He didn't get an opportunity to drive the run home. Won't have to drive in the run. It's a balk. Jacobson twitches off the back of the mound. That back left leg moved too soon. Trankel comes home to score standing, and it's 8-0 Anglers. Nothing going right for Will Jacobson. When you're hot, you're hot. The Anglers didn't have to do much after that. And when the bases were empty after that balk, Jacobson stayed on. He was not removed from the game in that second inning. He completed it through Max Romero's second at-bat in second innings and his second big swing in two innings. Infield goes back. Nobody on, one away. 1-1. Breaking ball smashed. Deep right. Bridges gives it a look at the wall. Max Romero does it again. His second homer in two innings. It's 9-0 Chatham. What has gotten into these Chatham A's? Max Romero, greeted by his teammates at home plate. They're in shock. The Anglers, with six runs in the second inning, have a 9-0 lead, and Max Romero's putting on a clinic. He put on a clinic, but it would not stop there. The Anglers, a 9-0 lead through two innings. Cotuit would answer with a three spot off Adam Tulloch in the top of the third with a Jace Grady two-out, three-run home run. But Cotuit would not score the rest of the ball game. Trevor Martin with dominant relief. Garrett Crowley finished it off cleanly. And Max Romero got one more chance to put oohs and ahs into the Chatham crowd.
0-1 offering. Hit high, right field, it's deep, it is gone! A hat trick for Max Romero! The Vanderbilt catcher leaves the park for the third time today. 11-3 Anglers lead. The dugout empties for the Vanderbilt catcher, who can do no wrong tonight.
Icing on the cake. Cotuit would not score the remainder of the way. Max Romero with three home runs, becoming the ninth Cape League hitter to go deep three times in a single game. A home run in the first, a home run in the second, and a home run in the fourth for the Vanderbilt catcher. Part of a 12-run, 13-hit effort for the Anglers, downing the Cotuit Kettleers 12-3 tonight at Veterans Field. Those postgame highlights brought to you by the Chatham Athletic Association. Chatham with the power hitting, the power pitching, but the first offensive barrage of any sort this season, and their first laugher of the season. They go into the off day on the right note. Thanks so much for tuning in to Chatham A's Baseball on the Cape Cod Baseball Network. Chatham defeats Cotuit 12-3. At Veterans Field, a three-homer night for Max Romero. Adam Tulloch, 3 1/3 innings of three-run ball. Trevor Martin strikes out 6 3 2/3. The Anglers roll to their best victory of the season. 9 runs across the first two. Anglers an off day tomorrow. Back in action Friday. They improve to 10-14-3. Cotuit drops to 11-14. Chatham Anglers on Facebook, at Chatham Anglers on Twitter. Chatham Anglers on Instagram, 800-846-4700, code 3841 to tune into every Chatham A's broadcast, home and road. Chatham Anglers Broadcast Central. For the entire media team, for my partner Ben Shulman, Emmanuel Berbari, Chatham A's Baseball. Anglers win 12-3 tonight. So long.
This has been an exclusive presentation of Chatham A's Baseball on TRZ Team Line. Chatham on TRZ.